A very good afternoon to all of you. I'm Professor Indika Karunathilaka, joining with you from the Sri Lanka Medical Association, and I'm the president of Sri Lanka Medical Association. And on behalf of SLMA, I warmly welcome all of you for this very important webinar on breaking the chain of transmission of COVID-19 through community engagement and community empowerment. This is a very timely topic, considering the current situation at our country, and now the country slowly moving towards restarting the normal life, or probably the new normal, as we may say. And today, we have joined with a very elite panel of resource persons that represent a range of disciplines, including the medicine and the health professions, health communication, law enforcement, apparel industry, hospitality industry, and lot of participants who are ranging from different disciplines. Sri Lanka Vaidya Sangame wenuwin mema ita wedagat antarjala hamuwata ekku oba sielu denama mama itama sadarin piliganwa me ita wedagat avasthawak makti sadayat aba dawase saakatcha karanne COVID-19 aasadane palane kirima sambandhe apa kohomada prajawa denuwat kalayutti This webinar will be conducting as a trilingual event. So again, this is another historic event for all of us, because we want to reach out to the general public and convey the message, because this webinar is all about community engagement and empowerment. I am joined with Dr. Kumarendran, who is a young SLMA council member, as well as Dr. Sankarandini Kumar, who is from primary care. Both of them are from primary care. In addition to that, in the panel, we have very eminent senior SLMA resource persons and members, including Professor Atul Sumathipala. Dr. BJC Pereira will be joining us very soon. And in the panel, we have several resource persons, including Professor Amal Kumarage, DIG Ajit Rohana, then from the Mass Holdings, we have Mr. Yusuf Salim and Mr. Ranil Vitarana and Dr. Shirani Chandrasri from the College of Microbiologists, and Dr. Dinil Abhigunawardhana, who is a specialist in health communication. So we have a range of specialists covering many areas that are relevant to community empowerment and engagement. Dr. Kumarendran, over to you.
Right, okay, thank you. அதாவது சமூகத்தை சமூக பங்கெடுப்பும் மற்றும் சமூகத்தினரை வலுவூட்டல் தொடர்பாக நாங்கள் எவ்வாறாக இந்த கொரோனாவின் தொற்றை தடுக்கலாம் என்பது சம்பந்தமான வெபினாரில் பங்கு பெற்றும் அனைவருக்கும் இலங்கை மருத்துவ சங்கத்தின் சார்பில் நாங்கள் நிறைவேற்றுகின்றோம். இதனை ப்ரொஃபஸர் இந்திகே கர்ணாத்தில் அவர்கள் தலைமை தாங்குகின்ற அத்துடன் வளவாளர்களாக பலர் பங்கு பெற்றனர், பல்வேறு துறையைச் சார்ந்த பலர் பங்கு பெற்றுகின்றார்கள். இதில் பேராசிரியர் அத்துல சுமதிபாலர், திரு அஜித் ரோகண, பேராசிரியர் அமால் குமாரகே, திரு ரணில் விதாரண, திரு டினில் அபயகுரமத்ன, திரு ஹிரான் கூரே, டாக்டர் ஷிராந்தி சந்திரஸ்ரீ மற்றும் திரு யூசுப் அவர்கள் பங்கு பெற்றிருக்கிறார்கள். நன்றி. தேங்க்யூ.
Thank you, Dr. Kumarendran. Now we'll straight away move into the webinar. We'll start with a panel of resource persons, each of them discussing from their angle how we can ensure the community engagement and empowerment in breaking the transmission chain of COVID-19. We'll be starting with one of the eminent resource persons who is an expert on community empowerment. Do we have Dr. Atul Sumithipala with us now? Dr. Pramod? Is Dr. Professor Atul Sumithipala?
I think he's there.
Professor Atul Sumithipala, you are there?
Yes, unfortunately, my camera is not working, but that's all right.
That's all right. Yeah. Professor Sumithipala, now you are an expert on community empowerment and engagement. Can you tell us why this community engagement and empowerment? I mean, samaj balaganneema saha samaj danwat kirima ithamath wedagath wenne COVID-19 aasadane patirim walakaga.
මේ මට ආරාධනය කරාට මේ ගැන කතා කරන්න. අපි බලමු මොකද්ද මේ community engagement කියන්නේ. ඒ කියන්නේ ප්‍රජාව උදු සහභාගීත්වය නෙමෙයි ප්‍රජාව පංගුකාරීන් බවට හරවා ගැනීම තමයි ඇත්තටම engagement කියන එකෙන් අදහස් කරන්නේ. ඊළඟට community empowerment කියන එකෙන් අපි අදහස් කරන්නේ ජනතාව බල ගැන්වීම මේ සංකල්පය සමග අපි නිවැරදි කරගෙන ප්‍රවේශයේ තවත් අත්‍යවශ්‍ය කාරණයක් තියෙනවා මේ කොවිඩ් සම්බන්ධයෙන් මොකද දැන් බොහෝ දෙනා පාවිච්චි කරන්නේ සමාජ දුරස්ථකරණය කියන වචනය ඒ කියන්නේ social distancing කියලා හැබැයි ඇත්තෙන්ම මේක ශාරීරික දුරස්ථභාවය කියන එකට නිවැරදි වෙන්න ඕන මොකද කොරෝනා මර්ධන සටනේ ප්‍රජාව පංගුකාරයන් බවට පත් කරලා ඕංග බල ගන්නනකොට ඇත්තටම වෙන්නේ සමාජීය වශයෙන් දුරස් වීමක් නෙමෙයි සමාජ ඒකාබද්ධතාවය අපි කියන ඉංග්‍රීසියෙන් we call it social integration සහ සමාජ ඒකාග්‍රතාවය that is social cohesion එතකොට මේකත් එක්ක අපි කරන්නේ වෙනකටත් වඩා මේ සාමූහික සමාජ වගකීම ගැන තේරුම් අරන් කටයුතු කිරීම එතෙන්දී දැන් ගිලෙන නැවකින් මිනිස්සු ගොඩ දාන්න බෑ සාකච්ඡා කර කර ඉඳලා මේකේ මුල් ප්‍රවේශ අවධියේදී ෂණික ලෙස තීන්දුව తీරන අරන් කටයුතු කරන්න සිද්ධ වුණා ඒක ඉතාමත්ම නිවැරදි ලෙස දේශපාලන අධිකාරිය ත්‍රිවිධ හමුදාව ඊළඟට ප්‍රජා සෞඛ්‍ය වෛද්‍ය නිලධාරීන් සෞඛ්‍ය දෙපාර්තමේන්තුව මැදිහත් වෙලා මේ මුහුද මැදදී නැවක ඇතිවිය හැකි අර්බුදය වගේ සංසන්දනය කරොත් ගොඩ බිම දක්වා ගෙනල්ලා තියෙනවා දැන් මේකේ අත්‍යවශ්‍ය කාරණයක් තමයි මේකේ තුන්වෙනි පාර්ශවය කොටස්කාරයෝ කියන ජනතාව මේකේට සක්‍රීය ලෙස ඇක්ටිව්ලි සක්‍රීය දායකත්වය ලබා ගන්න කටයුතු කිරීම. ඒක තමයි ඇත්ත වශයෙන් මෙතෙන්දී මේ අපි ප්‍රජාව පංගුකාරයන් බවට පත් කර ගැනීම සහ ප්‍රජාව බල ගැන්වීම කියන එකෙන් අදහස් වෙන්නේ. දැන් මෙතෙන්දී පොඩි මේ අභියෝගයක් තියෙන මොකද්ද මේ කොරෝනා වෛරසය කියන්නේ අලුත් දෙයක් නිසා මේක විද්වතුන්ටත් අලුත් මුළු ලෝකෙටම අලුත්. එතෙන්දී අපිට හුඟක් විද්‍යාත්මක සාක්ෂි පරිශන හරහා ගොඩනගිච්ච සාක්ෂි නැහැ. තියෙන්නේ විද්වතුන්ගේ එකඟතාවයෙන් විශේෂඥ දැනුම ප්‍රගුණ කළ අයගේ එකඟතාවයේ උඩ යම් යම් එක්ස්පර්ට් ඔපිනියන් කන්සෙන්සස් කියන දේ ගොඩනගාගෙන ඒක ඉදිරියට ගෙන යෑම. දැන් ඇත්තටම ගත්තාම මේ ප්‍රජාව බල ගැන්වීම සහ එකතු කිරීම කියන සංකල්පය අපේ වෛද්‍ය සංගමයේ අලුත් දෙයක්ුත් නෙමෙයි අපට අලුත් දෙයක්ුත් නෙමෙයි. දැන් මම ඉන්දික මතක් කරන්න කැමති මීට අවුරුදු දෙකකට ඉස්සෙල්ලා ශ්‍රී ලංකා වෛද්‍ය සංගමයේ වාර්ෂික සැසිවාරවලදී අපිත් මම නියෝජනය කරන ලංකාවේ පරිශ්‍රණ සංවර්ධන ආයතනයත් එකතු වෙලා අපි වැඩමුළු තිබ්බා. හැබැයි ප්‍රජාව දායක කරගන්න පරිශ්‍රණ කටයුතු සඳහා දැන් අපි ඔබට ගිහින් දැන් මේ කරන්න හදන්නේ ප්‍රජාව බල ගැන්වීම. දැන් උදාහරණයක් වශයෙන් ගත්තාම ඇත්තටම රජරට විශ්වවිද්‍යාලයේ තියෙනවා සෞඛ්‍ය ප්‍රවර්ධන දෙපාර්තමේන්තුවක් කියලා. ඒකත් මේ වෙනකොට මේ කටයුතු කරමින් පවතිනවා. ඒ විතරක් නෙමෙයි රටේ ජනතාව ඇත්තෙන්ම මේ කටයුත්තට පංගුකාරයෝ විදිහට මැදිහත් වෙලා තියෙනවා. ඉන්දික මට එක විනාඩියක් දෙන්න මේක ගැන පොඩ්ඩක් තව කරුණු ටිකක් කියන්න. දැන් මේ මේකේ සමස්ත ප්‍රවේශයේ වෛද්‍ය සංගමයේ උත්සාහ කරන්නේ අපි විද්වතුන් ඒ වගේම පරිපාලකයන් දේශපාලඥයන් මේක මේකේ ඉදිරිපෙළ කටයුතු කරන ක්‍රියාකාරකීන්ට අමතරව දැන් ජනතාව මේකේ කොටස්කාරී බවට පත් කරගන්න. ඒක ඇත්තෙන්ම ආපදා කළමනාකරණේ ඉතාමත්ම වැදගත් ගෝලීය සංකල්පයක් තමයි මේ ජනතාව මේ කටයුත්තට බද්ධ කරගන්න. මේ සිරියාව වගේ රටවල් වලත් මේ යුද අර්බුද තියෙන තැන්වල පවා මේ කටයුත්ත සිදු වෙමින් පවතිනවා. ඉතින් මම විශ්වාස කරනවා මේ වෛද්‍ය සංගමය මැදිහත් වෙලා මේ කරන්නේ ඉතාමත්ම වැදගත් දෙයක්. මොකද්ද ජනතාවට අපි උඩින් පටවන් නැතුව ඒක සක්‍රීය ලෙස බිමට ගේන. දැන් අපේ මෙතන ඉන්නවා නියෝජ්‍ය පොලිස්පතිතුමා අජිත් රෝහණ මහත්තයා, එතුමා පැහැදිලි කරයි. කලින් මුල අවධියේදී අපිට තිබුණේ ජනතාව තෘෂ්ණිම්බූත වෙලා ජනතාවට මේක අලුත් දෙයක් වෙලා එතකොට යම් කිසි විදිහේ ආධිපත්‍යයක් දරලා උඩින් නියෝග දාලා මේ කටයුතු කරන්න සිද්ධ වුණා. හැබැයි කාලයක් යනකොට ඇඳිරි නීතිය ඉවත් කරා ජනතාව යම් වගකීමකින් කටයුතු කරන ස්වභාවයක් එනවා. මොකද මේකේ ලර්නින් කර්ව් කියලා එකක් තියෙන ඉන්දික අපිත් ඉගෙනමින් පවතිනවා ජනතාවත් ඉගෙනමින් පවතිනවා මේක වැඩ කටයුත්ත කිරීම හරහා ඉගෙනීම. මම අවසාන වශයෙන් කියන්න කැමති නැවත ප්‍රවේශයට එන ඉස්සලා මේ අපි කියන මේ ප්‍රජා බල ගැන්වීම ප්‍රජාව පංගුකාරයන් බවට පත් කර ගැනීම මේක මේ හුදු විද්වතුන්ගේ හිතලුවක් නෙමෙයි. මේ වෙනකොට මේ බිමේ සිදු වෙමින් පවතින දෙයක්. බුත්තල සිද්ධ වෙනවා, මෙදවච්චියේ සිද්ධ වෙනවා, කන්තලේ සිද්ධ වෙනවා, මිහින්තලේ සිද්ධ වෙනවා. ප්‍රමෝද අපිට පුළුවන් ද ඒ පිළිබඳ පොඩ්ඩක් සාක්ෂි ටිකක් වෙන්නන්න මේ සහභාගී වෙන්න.
මහාචාර්ය අතුල සමදිපාල මැතිතුමනි අපිට ඒ සමගම මේ දකින්න පින්තූර සමග ඒ සමග විස්තරයක් කරන්න පුළුවන් නම් මම හිතන වඩා සුදුසුයි නේද
Hello? जनताव बलगेन वेला जनताव मेवेन कोट मे खटयुत्तट अवतीर्ण वेला तीनवा अपिट तीयन्ने एक तवत बिंगत करने का किया तमाई मां विश्वास करने ओबतुमानला देक्का ओय समहार देवल मे प्रजाव विसिंग मेदिहत्वेला करपु देवल दै उदाहरणयक वशयेन मे तमांगे पौल ऐतुले निर्माण करोदन वार गान ए साकच्चा गम ऐतुले करन देवाल इतिंग मे अपि मे साकच्चा वहरा मट मेक अत्र वशयेन पेन्नन्न ओन कम तिबुणे दनटत् मेवा सिदुवेमिन पवतिनवा मेक बिम्गत कल हैकी देयक् दन अपि दक्क पहुगिय काले ताप्प गाने चित्र दिन्न पटन गत्त जनताव ए जनतावट विभवयक् तियनवा अर्बुद ऐतुले विशेषयेन्म श्रीलंकीय जातियट अर्बुद ऐतुले अपि දැන් බල ගැන්වෙන තුන්වෙනි අධිරයට ඇවිල්ලා තියෙන්නේ පළවෙනි අධිරයේ තෘස්ලිම් බූත වෙලා බය වෙලා එකතැන් වෙලා කර කියා ගන්න දෙයක් නැතුව හිටියා දෙවෙනි අධිරයේදී ලර්නින් කර්ව ඉගෙන ගන්නවා අපි ඉගෙන ගන්නවා වෘත්තිකය ඉගෙන ගන්නවා පාලකයෝ ඉගෙන ගන්නවා හමුදාවල් ඉගෙන ගන්නවා සෞඛ්‍යංශය ඉගෙන ගන්නවා ජනතාවත් ඉගෙනමින් දැන් අපි ඇවිල්ලා තියෙන්නේ මේ පෝස්ට් ඩිසාස්ටර් බල ගැන්වීම අධිර අපි අපි එකතැන් වෙලා තෘස්ලිම් බූත වෙලා ඉන්න තැන නෙමෙයි මං හිතන්නේ මීට වඩා සාක්කියක් අවශ්‍ය නැහැ කියලා මයෙන් අනිත් සම්පත්දායකයන්ට ඉඩ දීලා ඉස්සරහා මේ කටයුතු පිළිබඳව තවත් සාකච්ඡා කරන්න ඉන්දික ඔබතුමාට මං අවසර දෙනවා ඉඩ දෙන්න
බොහොම ස්තුතියි මහාචාර්යතුමනි thank you for showing that how important the community empowerment and the community need to take the ownership and they have to take the decisions into them so when the day comes where even those from vulnerable populations they start educating each other on hand hygiene or keeping the physical distancing I think then our objective would have been achieved that would have been a real indicator of achieving our objective dr kumarendran can you briefly summarize proximity pala's ideas
You need to unmute him.
பேராசிரியர் அத்தல சுமதிப்பாளர்கள் சமூகத்தினரை எவ்வாறு பந்துபெறச் செய்வதும் மெதல் சமூகத்தினர் எவ்வாறாக பல மூட்டுவதும் இந்த கொரோனா கட்டுப்பாட்டில் முக்கியமானது என்பதை தெளிவுபடுத்தியிருந்த இதன் போது இந்த சமுதாயத்தினர் தாங்கள் தங்களது சுவாதத்தினை தமது கையிலேயே ஏற்றுக்கொள்ளும் அதை அதுக்குரிய பொறுப்பினை தாங்களே ஏற்றுக்கொள்ளும் நிலைமையினை நாங்கள் கொண்டு கொள்ள வேண்டியது அதே போல நாங்கள் பொதுவாக நாங்கள் சோசியல் டிஸ்டன்சிங் சொல்லுவோம் அதாவது சமூகத்திலிருந்து விலகி இருத்தல் என்று வந்ததை பாவிக்கிறோம் அதை விட நாங்கள் உடல் அளவு ரீதியில் நாங்கள் விலகி இருக்க வேண்டும் ஆனால் சமூகம் என்ற முறையில் நாங்கள் ஒன்றுபட்டு பல்வேறுபட்ட சுகாதாரம் பாதுகாப்பு செயல்களை செய்ய வேண்டிய இருக்கும் என்பதை குறிப்பிட்டார் அதே போல நாங்கள் சமூக மட்டத்திலும் அல்லது குடும்ப மட்டத்திலும் வெவ்வேறு சுகாதார ஏற்பாடுகள் செய்யும் போது அவற்றை பட்டியலிட்டு எவ்வாறாக நாங்கள் பொறுப்பாக செய்ய முடியும் என்பதையும் தெளிவுபடுத்தி இருந்தார் இதே போல ஆரம்பத்தில் ஊரடங்கு சட்டம் வலு கடுமையாக நடைமுறைப்படுத்தப்பட்டு எல்லோரும் தமது வீடுகளே இருக்க வேண்டிய இருந்தாலும் அதன் பின்னர் அவர்கள் படிப்படியாக இந்த நோய்க்கு எவ்வாறு முகம் கொடுப்பது என்பதை பல்வேறு துறையினரும் அவற்றை கற்று அல்லது அவற்றை அறிந்து கொண்டு தமது கட்டுப்பாட்டுடன் எவ்வாறாக தமது வலிமையான செயற்பாடு செயற்படலாம் பெறலாம் என்பதை நாங்கள் தரப்புகிறார்கள் நன்றி தேங்க்யூ
Thank you, Dr. Kumarendran. Now, the challenge is how to get this message across to the community. Because as you know, the Far Eastern countries, they have been living with different pandemics so over many decades. So for them, those behaviors are inculcated into the culture. But here, we have a challenge. So how to get these messages, how to get these health messages, or in summary, the behavioral changes into the community. Today we have an expert or a specialist in health communication, Dr. Dinil Abeyagunawardhana. Are you here?
Yes, Indika.
Yes, can you briefly tell in Sinhala and English both overall approach?
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much, Indika, and thanks for having me here. So what I'll do is to start with, to answer your question, we'll probably look at the conceptual basis of what we need to do. So this was, made somewhat easy, or rather fairly easy, by what Professor Sumathipala said. Thank you very much, sir. Now, the point is this. Now, what do we need to do? Now, we have a message on one hand, right? We have the message, and then we have our target population. So we pass the message to target population. Is that good enough? The point here is that is not good enough. The simple communication is not enough, because if you look at the whole scenario, what needs to happen is once the message receives the target population, there has to be a behavioral change between the target population for us to achieve this, whatever we are after. So it is the changed behavior that will stop the chain of transmission, or that will get us across, this pandemic. So I think there are two aspects to this. One is crafting the message that is, the experts in the panel, the other people who are in the SLMA, and all the people who have a stake in this have to get together and craft the message in such a way that it will hit, or in such a way that it will be understood by the general public. Because if you look at the whole thing, that virus transmission happens at the individual level. So it's empowerment of the individual. Now, once the message is received, I think we have to have another layer here to make sure that it is sort of absorbed, digested, and put into practice. Now, we know that the behavior is fairly contextual. Now, let's take an example from the medical field itself. The people who get trained surgically, right? How you scrub, right? How you put on a mask. The moment you get into that environment, your behavior changes. The moment you wash your hands, there's a certain way you fold your hands together and move around within the theater. But the same person, when they come out, what happens is, out of that context, right? Out of that area, the behavior again changes. So now what we need to do is, our people for ages have been behaving in a certain way within their normal environment, within the household, while traveling, right? So what we are trying to do here is bring out a behavioral change within their normal day-to-day life. So these are the challenges we face. Indika, do you want me to go and quickly summarize that in Sinhala as well?
Yeah, go ahead in Sinhala.
Yeah, දැන් අපි මෙතෙන්දී කල්පනා කරලා බලන්න ඕනේ මේ මේකේ මේ මේ මේකේ සංකල්පමේ පදනම මොකක්ද කියන එක. දැන් මහාචාර්ය අතුල සුමතිපාර මහත්මයා හරි ලස්සන වචන දෙකක් කිව්වා. අපි මේකේ ජනතාව පංගුකාරයින් කිරීම සහ ඔවුන් බල ගැන්වීම කියලා. එතෙන්දී අපි දැන් මේකේ සංකල්පමේ පදනම මෙහෙම කල්පනා කරමු. දැන් අපි කියන මැසේජ් එකක් තියෙනවා, පණිවිඩයක් තියෙනවා. මේ පණිවිඩේ යන්න ඕන කාටද? මේ පණිවිඩේ යන්න ඕන සමාජයට. ඒක තමයි අපේ ටාගට් එක. පණිවිඩය ගියන් පස්සේ මොකද වෙන්න ඕනේ මේ ටාගට් පොපියුලේෂන් එක. ඒ කියන්නේ මේ ඉලක්ක පිරිස තුළ යම් behavioral change එකක්, ඔවුන්ගේ කල් ක්‍රියාවේ වෙනසක් ඇති විය යුතුයි මේ මේ මැසේජ් එක නිසා. ඉතින් එතෙන්දී සෞඛ්‍ය පැත්තේ ඉන්න මේක මේ පැත්තේ මේ පොලිසි පැත්තේ, ඒ කියන්නේ මේකේ දේවල් මේ හදන කල්පනා කරන කට්ටිය කල්පනා කරන්න ඕන අපේ මිනිස්සුන්ට තේරෙන විදිහට මේ මැසේජ් එක යවන්න. ඒතර එතනින් එහා තවත් ලේයර් එකක් තියෙනවා මෙතන. ඒක තමයි මේ මිනිස්සු මේක තේරුම් අරගෙන ඒගොල්ලන්ගේ එදිනෙදා ජීවිතයේ යම් වෙනස්කමක් ඇති කළ ගැතියි. මෙන්න මේක අපි දකින්නවා, මේක තමයි අපිට තියෙන ලොකුම අභියෝගයක් කියලා. මොකද හේතුව දැන් මේ අපේ චර්යාව කියන දේ හැමතිස්සෙම යම් කන්ටෙක්ස්ට් එකකට, යම් සන්දර්භයකට බැඳිලා තියෙනවා. ඒ කියන්නේ අපි එක්තැනක අපි ඉගෙනගෙන තියෙනවා මෙන්න මෙහෙමයි මෙතන හැසිරෙන්නේ කියලා. දැන් වෛද්‍ය විද්‍යාවේ යෙදෙන කෙනෙක්, ශල්‍ය වෛද්‍යවරයෙක් අතපය හොදලා තියටර් එක ඇතුලේ හැසිරෙන විදියක් කියනවනේ. ශල්‍ය වෛද්‍යවරයම වුණත් එළියේදී ඒ විදිහටම හැසිරෙන්නේ නැහැ. මේ අපි කතා කරන්නේ සමාජයේ අවුරුදු ගානක් උපන්දා සිට මිනිසුන්ගේ තිබිච්ච චර්යාවන් මේ පණිවිඩ හරහා වෙනස් කිරීම. ඒ කියන්නේ බල ගැන්වීම. ඒගොල්ල මේකේ පංගුකාරයින් වෙන්නේ මේ මෙන්න මේ දේ සිදු වුණා වටින් තමයි මම හිතන්නේ අපි ඔක්කොම එකතු වෙලා මෙන්න මේකට උත්තර හොයන්න ඕන කියන එක මම හිතන්නේ අර ලැබිච්ච මේ මුලින්ම මේ මහාචාර්ය සුමිත්වල මහත්මයාගෙන් ලැබිච්ච ඕපනින් එක මේකට හොඳ මේ පදනමක් කියලාත් මම හිතනවා. ඔවට වින්දික.
Thank you Dinil. මම හිතන්නේ ප්‍රවේශ සුමතිපාලට ආයෙපෝ දෙයක්
जनगत प्रजामूलिक संविधान स्वेच्छावि जनता मेधिया संविधान तीन उदाहरण मरणाधार समिति मरण මරණයට අවශ්‍ය සියලුම දේවල් හට් එක ගහන තැන ඉඳලා මරණයේ වල කපන තැන ඉඳලා මේ මේ මේක අපේ සංස්කෘතිය ඇතුලේ තියෙනවා ඒක නිසා අපි මේ සරලව මේ සංකල්ප තේරුම් අරගෙන අපි ප්‍රජාව සමග බද්ධ වීම නොඑක් ආකාරයේ මම විශ්වාස කරනවා දැනට තියෙන ක්‍රියාත්මක වෙන යටිතල පහසුකම් තියෙනවා ඒ කියන්නේ මිනිස්සු සමංව බලගැන්විලා තමන් ස්වේච්ඡාවෙන් කරන අන්නේ ඒ වගේ සංවිධාන මහිලා සමිති තියෙනවා ක්‍රීඩා සමිති තියෙනවා ශිෂ්‍ය එතකොට මෙතෙන්දී ඒ මට්ටමට සහ වැඩි ඕන නැහැ තමන්ගේ පාරේ gederin පටන් ගන්නවා තමන්ගේ පාරේ ඒක පටන් ගන්නවා මේ හැම අතින්ම අවසානයේ ගත්තාම දැන් මම දැකලා තියෙනවා චිත්‍රෝන් මහත්මයා නිතර බස් ගැන කතා කරන දෙයක් තියෙනවා එතකොට බස් එකේ යන ජනතාවට තියෙනවා පොලිස් නිලධාරියා නැගලා මේක පෙන්වන්න දෙන්නකන් ඉන්නේ නැතුව රණ්ඩු සර්වල් කරන්න නෙමෙයි තමන්ගේ මතේ ඊටාම සංයමයෙන් එතන ඉන්න අනිත් අයත් බලගන්නවලා ප්‍රියදුරු මහත්තයාට කියන්න ඔබතුමා කරන වැඩේ ගැලපෙන්නේ නැහැ ඔබතුමාගේ සෞඛ්‍යයටත් අපිටත් කියලා මම මේ කියන්න හදන්නේ අපිට දැනට තියෙන පහසුකම් යටිතල ව්‍යුහයන් පාවිච්චි කරලා මේක ඉස්සරහට ගෙනියන්න පුළුවන් කියලා මම විශ්වාස කරන ඉන්දික නමුත් ඒක මගේ මතය සහ බිමේ තියෙන සාක්ෂි මත කියන දේ මෙතන ඉන්න විද්වතුන් රාශියක් සහභාගී වෙන අපි සියලු දෙනාගේ මොකද මේ සටන තනි ඔලුවක් තුල ජයගත හැකි එකක් නෙමෙයි විද්වත් සංවිධාන එකතු වෙලා බල ගැන්විලා ඉගෙන ගනිමින් අපිත් මේක ඉගෙන ගනිමින් තව දුරටත් පවතින දැනුම සංවර්ධනය කිරීම තමයි කරන්න වෙන්නේ කියලා මම විශ්වාසයි.
Thank you Professor Sumathipala. So you believe that it's definitely possible and the necessary ingredients are within us within the
Sri Lanka. Absolutely, we are a nation of resilience. We are not necessarily just vulnerable. We saw this after tsunami. We saw this after all the calamities. Now after tsunami, before foreign aid or even the government intervened, the people who are living near the coastal belt intervened. We are a nation of very very collective will. The only challenge this time is people can't come too close physically. However, we will be more socially together. That social cohesion is what we need to promote. E balagannwanna anna e katayutta janathawa pangukaryan maadhyen kiyannona api kiyannona vidwathun kiyannona siru denama kiyala dan me wede rajaya ranaviruwo suwaviruwo tamange uparimen ganala thiyena dan me button ekak athata rang meke kotas karya bawata patthena janathawata dadi wagakimak thiyenawa ඒ වගේම ඒගොල්ලන්ට හැකි විභවයක් තියෙනවා අපේ රටේ ජනතාව ඉතාමත්ම බුද්ධිමත් කියලා මම විශ්වාස කරන සුළුතරයක් ඉන්න පුළුවන් ඒ අභියෝගාත්මක නීති රීති දාලා සමහරලාට බලහත්කාරයෙන් කරන්න සිද්ධ වෙන දේ නමුත් අති බහුතරයක් අර දිලින් දිනෙල් කිව්වා වගේ මේ අවසානයේදී මේ සියල්ල බොයිල් ඩවුන් වෙන්නේ චර්යාව පිළිබඳව ඒ චර්යාවේ වගකීම යුතුයකම තමන්ගේ අතර ගත්තොත් ඉන්දික මේ කටයුත්ත පහසු දෙයක් වෙන්නේ නැහැ
Thank you, Dr. Kumarendran.
Okay. இதில தில்லில் அவே குணவத்தனை குறிப்பிடும் போது குறிப்பிட்டிருந்தேன் அதாவது நாங்கள் சுகாதாரம் சம்பந்தமான தகவல்களை கொடுக்கும் போது அவை எமது நடாத்தையில் மாற்றம் ஏற்படக்கூடிய முறையில் நாங்கள் கொடுக்க வேண்டும் இதன் போது நாங்கள் முக்கியமாக நாங்கள் வழங்கப்படும் கருத்துக்கள் சம்பந்தமாக இருக்க வேண்டும் அதே போல மக்கள் அவற்றை புரிந்து கொண்டு அவர்கள் தங்களது நடாத்தையினை நல்ல முறையில் மாற்றக்கூடிய வகையில் நாங்கள் கொடுக்க வேண்டிய இருக்கும் இதேபோல் எடுத்துமட்டு சொல்லிச்சனா உதாரணமாக சத்திர சிகிச்சையின் போது சத்திர சிகிச்சையின் பின்னர் அவர்களது தற்றுவாதம் பேணுகின்றார்களோ அதேபோல நாங்களும் நமது சந்தர்ப்பங்களில் இவற்றை பயன்படுத்திக் கொள்ள வேண்டும். அதே போல பேராசிரியர் அத்துல சுமதி பாடகர்கள் குறிப்பிடும்போது சொல்லியிருந்தேன், அதாவது நமது சமூகத்திலே ஏற்கனவே பல்வேறு உதாரணங்களுக்கு எவ்வாறாக மக்கள் ஒன்றுபட்டு செயற்படுங்கள். உதாரணம் எடுத்தால் நமது மரண வீடுகளை ஏற்படும் போது அவற்றை நடத்துவதற்கு வாரம் ஒன்று உடன் சுனாமி என்பது எவ்வாறு நாங்கள் ஒன்றுபட்டு செயற்பட்டோம். இவ்வாறாக நாங்கள் பல்வேறுபட்ட படைத்தரப்பினரும் சுகாதாரத்துறையினரும் ஒன்றிணைந்து பல்வேறு செயற்பாடுகளை கொரோனா சம்பந்தமாக செய்திருந்தார்கள். இப்போது மக்கள் ஒன்றிணைந்து தமது பொறுப்பினை ஏற்றக்கூடிய காலம் அது. தேங்க்யூ.
Thank you, Kumarendra. So now we have looked from one angle, that's the behavioral change. And now we move to the other angle. The whole idea of this behavioral change is to break the chain of transmission. We have Dr. Shirani Chandrasiri, who is the president of the College of Microbiologists. Dr. Shirani, can you tell us what are the different points where this transmission can occur? And how can we break this transmission? What are the simple measures that you can take? Dr. Pramod, can you get Dr. Shirani? Okay, yeah. Till she comes in, then we'll let's move into the different sectors that we are discussing. She may be having some problems related to login. Okay, so the areas that we are thinking about, the chain of transmission, how this infection can occur when the workers, when they're at home or when they leave home, when they get into the transport, the public transport, in the public transport, or when they get out from the public transport, or when they enter the workplace, at the workplace, in the dining hall, in the washroom, or when they get back. There are different points where this infection or the transmission can happen. And public transport is one area, and that would be one of the largest, biggest challenges. We have one expert, a top expert related to public transport policies, who is Professor Amal Kumaragi from University of Moratuwa. Professor Kumaragi, would you like to brief us on what are the challenges and what are the recommendations that you can provide?
Professor Indika, and good afternoon to everybody. If I am to take the discussion forward, I think, as you mentioned, transport, and in particular public transport, will become one of the most vulnerable and areas that need to be protected. Why? Because that's an area where, because of the efficiency required in transferring or transporting large numbers of people in a short time, we have to get people together. We have to bring them together. And that's how we can efficiently transport them. So by the nature of public transport, we bring people from different households, put them together, and also keep them together for a considerable period of time. And there is constant interaction between people getting in and getting off. So that will be a great challenge to keep the same kind of security precautions that we observe both at home and also in our workplaces. Workplaces have much more space for us to move around. So if you take a large bus, for example, that will have about 25 square meters. And if it is advised that each person must have on average 1 square meter to himself or herself, then simply we need to not load a bus more than a large bus, not more than 25 people. Now, also I want to add, like was mentioned, that this will become a social challenge for people to be disciplined. We know that Sri Lankans are most indisciplined when on the road, whether you're driving or whether you're in a bus or in a queue, there is much for us to learn. So I think this becomes also a social challenge for us to instill that discipline at this time, together with transport. And I think that is something that is good for our society. Now, I just want to mention a couple of areas in which we can mitigate these problems. One is what we call demand spreading. Now, in transport, one of the big problems is the occurrence of what we call a demand peak, particularly in urban areas. There is 1 hour, 1.5 hours in the morning and in the evening, sometime during the midday, where a lot of people want to travel. And that is caused by offices, schools, factories, all opening at the same time. So we need to very consciously work out a program of what we call demand spreading, so that this 1-2 hour spread will be like 3-4 hours. The times you start, the times you end, how long you keep people, and the number of days that we bring a person to work, I think these are all flexible. And these are building blocks that we may need to keep changing as we open the economy so that we manage the demand, so that the same demand, same supply is available in our buses and trains throughout the day. So we need to, we cannot increase the supply, we have to reduce the demand. The second thing that I want to say is when people do get into the bus, there are certain things that we will need to instill. We need to work with the suppliers of the demand, that is the transport authorities, the people who regulate it, and as was mentioned, the people. And I think we need to create a self-regulatory, a self-identity of people maintaining those things. So we have been working on even introducing an app that people can have, which will identify their bus and be able to even upload a photograph if those conditions are breached. Of course, these things will cost money, and I think we need, government needs to think of this also as expenditure on maintaining adequate health standards. I think there's a issue now because particularly the private operators and even the state will not be able to maintain these 25 people to a bus unless they get the funding to bridge that revenue shortfall. So therefore, this is also a health expenditure, and it's not just a subsidy to the bus operator, a relief to the bus operator, but to maintain certain health standards. So that also needs to be looked at. There are also a number of IT-based interventions that are happening in other countries that we can use to get people more information about times of buses and even the level of loading in a bus so that they can make better choices, safer choices. That's all for now. Over to you, Professor Indika.
Thank you, Professor Kumaragi. I mean, you are someone who has done a lot of studies related to this area, related to these different mechanisms and policies. And within the Godak katha karana kohomada vividha kriya marga bhavitha karaganimin me පවතින අභියෝගයට මුහුණ දෙන්න මෙතන පවතින සම්පත් ප්‍රමාණය සීමා සහිතයි තියෙන බස් රථ සංඛ්‍යාව සීමා සහිතයි බස් රථ ඒ සීමා සහිත සම්පත් භාවිතා කරමින් ගණමින් කොහොමද අපි මේ පුද්ගල අතර දුරස්ථාවය පවත්වා ගණමින් මේ ගමන ගමනේ පවත්වා ගන්න යන්න ගැන තමයි ඔබ විශේෂයෙන් සඳහන් කරේ ડોક્ટર කුමරේන්ද්‍ර
හලෝ डिमांडिंग अरेकूर உவரான முயற்சி செய்வதன் மூலம் நாங்கள் போக்குவரத்தின் போது பாதுகாப்பினை அதிகரிக்கக்கூடிய
So, Professor Kumaragi, I mean, in spite of having those, all these different measures and the different methods and trying your best to have a distribution of the demand and reduce the demand, still, is there a possibility of a worst case scenario when the country slowly moves back into normalcy?
Hello, yes. Yes, I think we need to have an ongoing system where we can monitor. And that's why I mentioned that this is time to introduce IT into managing the supply of transport so that we can vary the demand very easily. Obviously, this is not going to be a static demand. Week by week, things will change. And we need to be able to adapt very quickly so that we make safety standards the benchmark, and then we are able to adjust both the demand side in terms of what is allowed to function at what time, and then the supply side as well. So I think this is time for the transport sector to embrace the technology. It has been one of the sectors that has been very resistant to modern technology, particularly IT technology. But and I think that is now more or less available for us to use, and we should use this.
Yeah. Thank you, Professor Kumaragi. Dr. Pramod, is it possible for you to unmute Professor Vasanthi Thevanesam? I saw her in the among the participants.
Oh,
Professor Thevanesam, yes. Yeah. I mean, now in a bus, that may not be ideal. What are the measures that the commuters can take to make sure that they don't get the infection? Professor Thevanesam, can you tell a few words till Dr. Shirani comes on board?
I suppose so. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Yes.
Right. It's very difficult, actually, because there are two, competitive sort of things. One is that the number of people who want to travel on a particular route and the availability of buses. So actually, I think for a start, until the availability of buses can be increased, I think we will have to stay with one of the key features or recommendations for reduction of transmission, and that is don't go out unless you have to. I think that has to be really promoted because as soon as you lift curfew, for instance, now, I'm in Kandy, and from roundabout Kandy, the buses are, well, they're hardly not there because only CTB buses are running and they take only 25. So the people who have to get to work spend 2 hours, for instance. I mean, for them, you can tell them, okay, you know, don't touch anybody, don't scramble to get on the bus, but the buses don't stop for most of them. So there is a conflict here of what you need and advising people in a very crowded bus is impossible, because they are contacting. So I think you have to go by what Professor Kumaragay is saying, and that is that you have to reduce the numbers in public transport, but you have to provide sufficient public transport as you loosen up the restrictions for those who need it. So, and then you can start telling people, okay, stand in a queue or whatever. But first and foremost, they must have the transport that they need. Is that sufficient?
Yeah. Thank you, Professor Thevanesam. I mean, in a way, worst case scenario, where people have to get into those kind of crowded places, I mean, is there a way we can inculcate this message that don't touch your face? Or
You can tell people not to touch their faces, but you know, in a crowded bus, their faces are so close to one another. Perhaps many of us don't travel in crowded buses, so we see them, but we don't actually experience it. So if you are, emitting the virus or whatever word you want to use for it, because you are an asymptomatic person and you have some virus coming out of you, you cough or you sneeze, not because you've got coronavirus, but because you cough or sneeze. I mean, there are lots of people with hay fever, for instance, who cough all the time in the mornings. So if they are emitting the virus, you are within just, droplet distance, really, and even less than the distance that you want. You know, you're face to face. So I think you have to find, say, some way of social distancing on public transport. If you don't find that, and if we have sufficient people, asymptomatic, pre-symptomatic, and maybe even post-symptomatic traveling on public transport, I think the virus will just spread. Sorry for being so pessimistic.
No, we have to think of the real. I mean, it's always safe to expect the worst case scenario and then be prepared. Again, we have one of the best persons to tell us about it. Now, as it was highlighted, these behaviors take time to change. And meanwhile, you have to ensure that the crowd behavior and those disciplines has to be inculcated. We have a DIG, Ajith Rohana, who doesn't need any introduction and who has been very much involved and doing a huge service from the very beginning. DIG Ajith Rohana, would you like to
Yes. At the very outset, I would like to express my sincere appreciations to Sri Lanka Medical Association and all the panelists and the moderators for giving this opportunity to express few things about the existing situation, and apart from that, what we need from the general public, especially from the 11th of May. As you all know, 11th of May, we are going to open the country, especially the areas in Western Province, Colombo City, Gampaha, and whilst the imposing curfew, we need to run the country. So therefore, what we expect from the general public. And before that, let me talk about the corona outbreak or the action taken by the state parties since the inception of this pandemic. As you all know, the first COVID positive patient was found on the 27th of January 2020. Now it has already been completed for 4 months. And the first, she is a Chinese national, and the first Sri Lankan COVID positive patient was discovered on the 11th of March, 2020. Now today, as of today, now it has been almost 60 days since the first Sri Lankan patient was found. Now, during this period, where we are, if you take the international, the world statistics in respect of corona, the COVID, approximately 4 million COVID positive patients have covered. And apart from that, 270,000 deaths have been reported. And according to the categorization of World Health Organization, the number one country, the affected country is the United States. Number two is Spain. The third one is Italy. The fourth one is UK. Number five, Russia. Number six, France. So now where we are, what is our number? What is our place? Our number is 160 in comparison to all these countries in the world. I mean, according to the statistics, there are 197 countries. They are the members of the United Nations. So we are at 160. So therefore, I believe we have achieved something in comparison to the world statistics. I think 190 is Bhutan, and apart from that, there are countries, very small countries, islands. They don't have bigger population, 1,000 like. Therefore, our number is, our place is the countries in the world. And you take the statistics, the corona positive patients in Sri Lanka, as of today, we have 824 along with 9 deaths. The death rate of Sri Lanka is 1.09%. But if you take the other countries, the number one health, there are countries, as you all know, France is the number one country in respect of health facilities. Number two is Italy, the USA. So USA, they are having 32 ICU beds, whereas we have 2 ICU beds per 100,000 population. But we are our place is 160. So how we achieved all these things? Still the coronavirus is spreading and we have a threat, but we have achieved something in comparison to the COVID positive patient population and as well as the deaths, because the Sri Lankan general public, they adhered with the things that we said constantly. Since we imposed the curfew on the 18th of March, initially in respect of Puttalam district and Kochikade police area, and gradually it was spread to the whole island. We have completed almost 55 days, and Sri Lankan people, they are living with curfew. We had challenges. However, so being the member of the main law enforcement agency of the country, I can say that our people are well disciplined. 99% of the people, they are disciplined and they followed the instructions given by police and other authorities. But in implementing law, Professor Kumarage, the other the experts, they mentioned about this public transportation, then the behavioral habits or the other behavioral issues in respect of public places. So accordingly, so we need two things. We have two issues. Number one, health issue. Number two, legal issues. So amalgamating all these issues, now we have formulated a special gazette notification, which will be published tonight or tomorrow or Sunday, because now since the inception of this corona pandemic in Sri Lanka, we arrested persons only during the curfew period. After the 11th of May, we need to implement law in respect of the bystanders or the general public. But the curfew is being imposed. And apart from that, we need to correct their habits and all these things in respecting the health norms. So especially as we have identified as the epidemiologists or the experts in the field, as you all mentioned. So there are three things involved in respect of community empowerment. Number one, social distancing. Number two, washing hands with liquids or soaps every time. And number three, this is the most important thing, because at the inception we observed that we had 13 or 18 cases, because after that the clusters were invented, because many patients at the inception, they were reluctant to reveal their diseases, symptoms. So that was the problem we had since the inception. But generally the social distancing is not a very big problem now. The people had adhered with the rules and regulation. And apart from that, the washing hand is also one of the habits of Sri Lankans, at the moment. But still, we are having the problem in respect of revealing or divulging the symptoms or the suspected cases. So this is the biggest problem at the moment we are having. But the other two issues also, they are there. But we need to address this particular issue to empower general public. If they are having the symptoms or suspected symptoms, so immediately they have to divulge it. They have to inform the police. They have to inform the health authorities. Then and there, we could take action. As you all know, in this particular whole scenario since the 11th of March, we had 31 clusters. The biggest cluster is the Navy cluster. How this Navy cluster generated? Because of a drug addict. So he created four clusters. Number one, Jail Sudwala cluster. Number two, Nagalagam Street cluster. Then Keselwatta Gunasingapura cluster and Navy cluster. So if we don't have these four clusters, still we are with at least 250 COVID positive patients. So therefore, especially, I would like to emphasize that we need to address these three issues, especially the social distancing. It won't be a very big problem now because the people, they accept the things we are saying and they are adhering. Number two, washing hands. And especially we need to address the third issue. Many people, the many patients, general public, they are reluctant to divulge their identity.
Thank you. Now, just one question. Say, imagine now, at the moment we are in a curfew situation. When the country gradually reopens, the situation may be slightly different. So in that way, how the maybe the police and the triforces get the community engaged in a positive way? Say, do you have plans to help them how to maintain the distance and to adhere to those physical distancing measures?
Yes, so I mean every time we express our views through the electronic media, sometimes through the print media, and I believe that especially now all these clusters were created in the Colombo city or in the vicinity of Colombo city or in suburbs areas, but apart from that, we had a cluster in Atulugama, Beruala, and Akurala. But other areas, we don't have a single case in Monaragala area. Even in Ampara, we had very few cases, but the persons who had gone from Colombo, they created that clusters. Anuradhapura, Polonnaruwa area, Polonnaruwa also, we have some quarantine camps. So other than that, we didn't have cases. So therefore, especially police and triforces, and apart from that, health workers, especially must mention the services tendered the health authorities, especially apart from these doctors, specialists, and epidemiologists, the tremendous service given by the PHIs and MOH officers. So therefore, we were able to acknowledge the general public and they adhere with all these social distancing concept. And apart from that, especially if we take the examples in respect of self-quarantine, the majority, 99% of the general public, they adhered with all these rules and regulations. Now, I think already approximately we have give up the health authorities inform 70,000 persons to be self-quarantined, and the majority of them, they have successfully completed that duration, that period. So therefore, I think the police and forces, we have taken considerable steps in respect of this issue.
Thank you, Dr. Nithrawana. So, I mean, it seems that the police and the triforces, they also have the confidence in the Sri Lankan citizen and the public. And hope all of us, everyone together, will be able to inculcate this positive culture in a positive way. Kumarendran, you want to summarize briefly?
பிரதி போலீஸ் அதிபர் அஜித் ரோஹன் அவர்கள் குறிப்பிடும் போது அதாவது ஒரு 190 நாடுகளை கருதுவோமாக இருந்தால் இலங்கையானது இந்த கொரோனா பிரச்சனையின் தரப்படுத்தல் பார்க்கும்போது 160வது இடத்தில் இருக்கிறது. அதாவது இலங்கையானது பலவேறு வசதிகளை கொண்ட மருத்துவ வசதிகளை கொண்ட நாடுகளுடன் பார்க்கும்போது இலங்கை சிறப்பாக செயற்பட்டிருக்கிறது. அதே போல எடுத்துக்கிட்டால் இறப்பு வீதம் கூட பல்வேறு வளர்ச்சியடைந்த நாடுகளுக்கு ஒப்பிடும் போது இலங்கை இறப்பு வீதம் 1.09 என்றவை மிக குறைவாக இருந்திருக்கிறது. அதே போல மக்களும் நன்றாக ஒத்துழைத்திருக்கிறார்கள். ஒரு 55 முருடச்சிடம் நடப்பு இருந்த போதும் இதில் நாங்கள் முக்கியமாக மூன்று விடயங்களை கவனிக்க வேண்டியிருக்கிறது. ஒன்று, ஒருவருடன் ஒருவர் இடைவெளியை பேணுவது. அடுத்ததாக கை சுகாதாரம், கைகளை ஒழுங்காக கழுவுவது. முக்கியமான மூன்றாவது விடயமா இருப்பது என்ன சொல்லிச்சுன்னா, யாருக்காவது நோய் அறிகுறிகள் இருக்குமா இருந்தால் அவர்களது நோய் அறிகுறிகளை ஒழிக்காம உரிய ஆரம்பத்திலேயே தமது நோய் அறிகுறிகளே கொரோனா சம்பந்தமான ஐயப்பாடு இருக்குமானால் அவற்றை உடனடியாக தாமதிக்காது வெளிப்படுத்துவது முக்கியமாக இருக்கும்.
அதே போல உதாரணம் எடுத்து முன்ன சொல்லிச்சுனால் ஒரு போதை பொருளுக்கு அடிமுனை ஒருவரால் அண்ணளவா ஒரு நாலு பிரச்சனைகள் எவரால் ஏற்படக்கூடியதாக இருந்தது. மாறாக ஆற்று பொறுப்பாக இருப்பது முக்கியமாக இருக்கு. தற்போதைய நிலைமை எடுத்து முன் சொல்லிச்சனம் என்றால் இந்த நோய் கொழும்புக்கும் கொழும்பை சுற்றியுள்ள சில இடங்களுக்கும் நாங்கள் மட்டுப்படுத்தப்பட்டுள்ளது. எனவே இனிய இடங்களில் நாங்கள் வந்து வளமையான நிலைமைக்கு போகக்கூடிய நன்றி. தேங்க்யூ.
Thank you, Dr. Kumarendran. Now we'll be moving to another practical area. Industry is a huge area when it comes to economy. We have two resource persons from Mass Holdings. I think Mr. Anil Vitharana and Mr. Salim Yusuf. Would you like to comment on what are the issues that you'll be facing and what are the measures that you are planning to take and what are the practical difficulties?
Right. Yes. Anil, you want to go first?
Yes, I'll just go first and explain as we MAS in Sri Lanka, we employ about 60,000 people, so the responsibility on the company was immense. We are also responsible for a lot of the foreign exchange income that comes into the country, and we also understood the fact that we need to get back to work as fast as possible. I will just only cover two areas. Sort of the as it were, the science behind some of the decisions that we took. So one was around, when you're in industry, you're not isolated. You continuously have things that are delivered to you, whether it's your raw material, whether it's bottles of water, any other, things that are delivered to you, then that are consumed by a majority of people. So one of the things that we had to try and understand was, how is a surface? So if we, for instance, get fabric delivered to us, is it safe for us to, touch that fabric? Is it, they come wrapped in polythene? How do you, is there a period of quarantine that product has to go through before you use it, etc.? So I think when you're looking at things holistically, it's important that you also try and understand, what can bring this in. So for us, as far as we were concerned, metals, where the product could, the virus could last the longest. And it was important that we brought in some disciplines around that. Then plastics, fabrics actually were the least. The second thing is if you are in an air-conditioned environment, there is a lot less moisture in there. As a result, the droplets dry out much faster. So that was a positive for us. So that was a basis on which some of our decisions around how, what sort of actions we take, and Yusuf will elaborate on those actions. The second one was around the whole face mask. 60,000 face masks is a lot of quantity. We just didn't have access to proper face masks. So we actually got together with the Sri Lanka Institute of Nanotechnology, started creating different types of face masks with different types of fabrics, and to try and understand what was the ideal face mask to use. And in doing so, we also looked at it because for us, what we assumed is we can look at this two ways. One is that I want to stop getting the coronavirus, or I want to stop giving the coronavirus. So I think for us, the main way that we looked at it was that the likelihood that 60,000 people who come to work across 50 facilities across Sri Lanka, that one of those people are going to be a carrier is going to be fairly high. So what we looked at was how do we stop that person from giving it away? So as we practice social distancing, as we sort of work in an isolated area, what is the risk of this, someone else, you infecting someone else? So we looked at the mask from a slightly different angle, which was to say, if a person is wearing a mask and they cough or they sneeze or they, once they're talking, that's where you have the highest velocity of these droplets. How do we prevent the droplet from hitting the person who is 1 meter away? So what we said was we wanted to develop it in such a way that that droplet doesn't go beyond about 30 centimeters. And then the next area was that the individual is responsible for cleaning that surface around that that 1 meter, the space that they have. So in the end, what we ended up was we had a mask which was made, a triple layer mask with a cotton outer, a brushed cotton inner. And this was also to do with the comfort of the wearer, because you have to wear this mask for a long, long period of time. And thirdly, the middle layer is, we found a fabric that is a non-woven, which is used to make the supermarket bags. I don't know whether you've seen the blue or red bags that Kiehl's or Food City, etc. give you. That fabric is fairly widely available in Sri Lanka. And so what we did was we used that in the middle layer. And with that, we also tested it for the number of washes that we can go through. Yeah. And we came up with a whole SOP in terms of how that works. And this mask is about, so if you look at a N95 mask, which obviously, you know, a 95% filtration efficacy, our mask in the test that we conducted at Slintec came out at about 65-70%. Now, when we compare this against a lot of masks that are available, including that brought in from China with the non-woven layers, we found that this was much more efficacious. It was also much more robust, allowing people to wash it and reuse it. So I'll let Yusuf continue from here on how we have put this all into practice.
Yeah, and
thanks, Ranil. Really, Indika, do you want to first translate that?
That's fine. That's fine. Yeah. And Mr. Yusuf, if you can tell what are the measures that you have taken to control that within your environment, because you are having a very large kind of industrial establishment, and with like Dr. Ms. Ranil mentioned, so many employees are there. So what it's a huge challenge to break this transmission cycle. So what were the specific measures related to that? And Ranil Vitharna Mahathaya kalin me karapu. කියන මාස්ක් එක හදන්න ගත ක්‍රියාමාර්ගය වගේ දේවල් පැහැදිලි කළා. ඒ වගේම කොහොමද මේ රෝගේ පැතිරීම වළක්වන්න ගත ක්‍රියාමාර්ග මේ වගේ විශාල කර්මාන්තශාලාවක් තුළ. You can yeah explain it in both languages. Yeah.
Sure, Indika. Sure, Indika. I'll if you don't mind, I'll do it in English first.
That's fine. Yes, and, please go ahead.
As Ranil mentioned, you know, for us, we are a large labor-intensive industry. As well as we are a large economic contributor, so there were risks on both sides. But the focus for us was to ensure employee safety. So what we did was we had to actually assess risk, starting with the employee life cycle, starting with third party engagements, employee accommodation, and also part of the manufacturing. Luckily for us, you know, being a very labor intensive industry, training is a day to day part of our job. So I think, Professor Sumati Pala and Dr. Dinil also touched on this area about behavior of people and getting them to take responsibility. And for us also, in order to run a world-class manufacturing organization, people need to be trained and people need to understand certain concepts so that they themselves practice. For example, you know, the traditional apparel industry was all about learning how to sew. But in today's industry, it's a lot more than that. We have to teach people the concepts of the Toyota production system, you know, elements of 5S, elements of safety, all of those things. So our training mechanism has evolved quite significantly, which helped us a lot. But I'll just touch a little bit about the areas that you specifically asked. So we started with, for example, employee life cycle, and that starts with transport and picking people up from home. So how do we ensure that people that get into our bus have been assessed to have a low or minimal risk of either being a carrier or somebody who has contracted COVID-19? So for that, we resorted into a questionnaire. We actually developed a very basic questionnaire about where they live, about whether they are having any symptoms, people around them, what has been, where have they traveled most recently. So we wanted to get an idea of how they have exposed themselves. Of course, this was a self-declaration, But we also went to the point of explaining why we are doing this, which meant that, you know, the chances were that they would be quite honest with it. Through the checklist, we actually gathered all this information and were able to decide whether that employee was a low risk, medium risk, or a high risk. And how we did that is we also have a lot of engagement on the ground with the Grama Niladaris. We have engagement on the ground with the public health inspectors. And also we have self-declaration from employees, and we try to build a picture of where there were COVID cases that were identified, whether somebody visited somebody else, and we immediately put this information into a database and assess up to a Grama Niladari level what are the high-risk areas. So immediately then we can identify what is the transport that is going to these high-risk areas, who are the employees that are coming in, and we can almost double click onto them in terms of, you know, asking them more questions, testing them, etc. From a transport standpoint, of course, we have put the basic protocols in place. And I think Mr. Amal also explained about this. The social distancing in our vehicles is now every other seat. So essentially our transport capacity has dropped by 50%. We get people to sanitize before they come in. We get people to ensure that they're wearing a mask, and we have adequate stocks of masks in every transport vehicle so that we can issue that if somebody is not wearing a mask and they come in. As soon as people enter the factory as well, we take their temperature. We make sure that they sanitize, so they wash their hands. The feet, we have those mats where we get them to wash their feet. And then we get them to come into the factory. In terms of canteen facilities, third-party providers, we have also created a checklist where we get all third-party service providers to do a self-disclosure, and we assess risk of all third-party service providers as well. We have brought all third-party service providers, for example, transport, and given them training on how to sanitize a bus, and using, I think, the Ministry of Health gave clear guidelines in terms of how to prepare sanitizers. We issue those sanitizers to them and run some demonstrations on how to train, how to sanitize vehicles, etc., prior to employees getting into the vehicle. Similarly, when it comes to canteen, we developed protocol and trained all third-party canteen service providers. And in fact, it was because of this training and this protocol that when there was one of our canteen suppliers who had come from a similar area as one of the Navy people, it was immediately alerted. We could isolate those people, we could get them tested without any risk. So again, I must emphasize, as much as we put protocols into place, Professor Sumathipala touched on, it is about making people understand the why, because now it is up to them to take this forward. Then if I move into the factory, the sewing module, or where people operate a set of machines, is the heart of our operation. And we needed to understand what are the changes we had to make in this sewing module in order to ensure that people were safe. So we had now done a questionnaire. We had assessed risk based on information we get from Grama Niladari. We had made sure that people were wearing a mask, that people were sanitizing, and people coming into the factory. But when they are doing their work, how do we make sure that these people don't transmit this to somebody else? So, we deployed a protocol of relaying out all our factory sewing modules based on a 1 meter shoulder to shoulder social distancing. So we also made sure that people were not facing each other in the operations. And if they were, we rechanged the modules to make sure people were facing side by side. We ensured that there was hand sanitizers available so that people could regularly sanitize themselves every 2 hours or so. We made sure that machines were sanitized with alcohol before the shift, each shift came in, so that that environment was safe. Subsequent to that, we also developed something like 41 protocols in total, 41 SOPs and 20 checklists, we had a broad group, what we call the internal ecosystem. So for example, we actually had some people to think of, okay, how do activities take place? So one key activity is meetings. And you have meetings that happen in meeting rooms. You have meetings that happen in the shop floor. How should the structure of these meetings change? If these meetings are to use a whiteboard, if these meetings are to use a projector, what are the protocols for using that projector? What are the protocols for using those whiteboard markers, etc.? And we almost had to develop a protocol for each of those areas. We then had material that moved within our ecosystem. So from our raw material stores, it came into our cutting area. From the cutting, it would go into embellishment, etc. So we had to look at each of those areas and understand what were the potential risks and what are the protocols that we need to put in place. However, the foundation remained, as what I explained before, every employee was checked before they came. They had to sanitize and they had to wear a face mask whilst at work. Ranil touched on this issue of how long the virus survives on different surfaces. Now for us as the apparel industry, that was a big one because we get raw materials from various suppliers, both local and international. We also do some value adding and we send the work outside for revalue adding and then bring it back into our facilities. We also send samples for testing, samples for fit, samples for approval, etc. So there was a lot of material movement and we developed a set of protocols for the external ecosystem where we based it on that information that Ranil shared, which was how long can a virus survive on a surface. And we had to look at both the internal packaging and the external packaging. So we went into a fair amount of detail to make sure that the work environment was a safe work environment for our employees. Indika, over to you.
Yeah, I think you have given a great insight. මෙතන ඇත්තම ඔබ පැහැදිලි කරලා දුන්නේ නිෂ්පාදන ක්‍රියාමාර්ගයේ එක එක පියවරවල් කොහොමද මේ වසංගතයේ පැතිරීමට අදාළ පියවරවල් සමග සංසන්දනය කරගන්නේ මේ පියවරවල්දී කොහොමද පැතිරීම වළක්වන්නේ කියන එක. ඒක අර ඔබ වගේ විශාල ව්‍යාපාරයකට ඒක කරන්න තියෙන හැකියාව ඉතා පැහැදිලිව පේනවා. ඒ වගේ මේ පියවරවල් ව්‍යාපාරයේ විශාල වුණත් පොඩි වුණත් මම හිතන්නේ ඒක සමාජිකම අදාළ වෙන්න ඕන කියන එක. ඒ කියන්නේ ක්‍රියාදාමයේ එක එක පිළිවෙලවල් කොහොමද මේ වසංගතයේ පැතිරීමේ පියවරවල් එක සංසන්දනය කරගනිමින් මේක වළක්වන්නේ කියන එක. Now this is not an easy thing. Now from the administrator's point of view, you can put on the regulations, rules and the protocols, but when it comes to the personal behavior, you have to give this message. Dr. Dinil, would you like to inculcate, tell us how we can inculcate these messages in an effective way? Dinil, over to you. And then I would Hello. Like to ask Dr. Kumarendran for the Tamil transmission. And then Dr. Sankar and Dr. Athara Sumathipal to take over towards the end of this session. Over to you, Dinil.
Thank you, Indika. It's a very interesting discussion. And we are learning, about the other sectors as well. Now, if I'm to highlight a couple of points that I have heard from Professor Kumarage, one thing he said really struck me. He said transport at a conceptual level is basically getting different people from different households and confining them to a small area. Right, and this is when you look at these situations, we have to basically go back and think about our strategy. So it's at the end of the day about empowering the individual, isn't it? The point is let's say you have the best mask, the best set of PPEs, right? And none of those are going to be useful unless they are used properly. So the people who are using them, people who are teaching, people who are supervising these, right, they got to be enforced, right? A half decent instrument or an equipment could be more useful, right, on a person who knows how to use it properly, right? Rather than, the best piece of equipment on a person who does not know how to use it. So it's at the end of the day, again, about, as Professor Sumathipala said, balagenmima and you know basically empowerment and engagement. And then I think there has to be another layer coming into this. So empowerment has to be first. Probably, you know, I mean, Sumadipala can shed some light on this as well later on. Empowerment, then we get them engaged. The third layer, I think, is enforcement. Right? We know that, okay, I mean, we will never get, you know, 100% engagement. But one person, as we discussed before, can basically, you know, wreak havoc. So the point is, you know, at a certain point, right, you try empowering people, then you get them engaged, and then, you know, a level, some sort of enforcement has to be there as well. So in principle, these are very, very important things. And I keep on saying in principle, because I think it's extremely important to get these things in principle first, rather than, you know, I mean, when we plan something, plan a project or something, right? We get the whole idea, the objectives and everything first in order, right? What's the goal? What are the objectives? And then only we look at the tasks, right? So if we get the goal right, the objectives right, then we will get the steps right, the tasks right, right? So the getting the policy, right, based on solid scientific facts becomes so important here. And I will basically utilize an example given by Professor Sumadipala at the very beginning. Now, look what has happened to the term that we are using at the moment, which is samaja durasthabhavaya or social distancing. As he said at the very outset, it's wrong, right? We don't need samaja durasthabhavaya or the social distancing. We need physical distancing, right? Now, because we haven't got the word right at the very beginning, now it has got, you know, into the society, and we are keep on utilizing that word, right? Which has a, you know, I mean, if you really look at it, has a sort of a different connotation. So, you know, I mean, in summarizing the whole thing, look, virus transmission happens at the individual level, right? And the PPEs and the masks and the protective equipment and the behavior is individual based, right? It's a behavior of the individual that leads to the behavior of the herd, isn't it? So I think, you know, I mean, empower the individual, right? And then, I mean, I have been listening to what Mr. Yusuf said and Mr. Anil said about what they have done at mass holdings. Now, being mass, right, and I think Mr. Hiranpure is also waiting to speak, right? I mean, their organizations are big organizations. As he himself said, the training is a huge part of what they do, right? But, you know, I mean, take mass on one hand, take on the other hand, the operator who has 5 sewing machines that operating at Pamunua. So how are we going to get through to them, right? So enforcement may be easy at a place like Mr. Yusuf's, right, at mass holdings. But enforcement will have to be at a national level, or maybe we have to completely let go enforcement and rely entirely upon empowerment and engagement when it comes to the small operators and, you know, I mean, the person we see on the road and every day. And then on the other hand, right, I mean, the person who gets on the bus, the mass bus, think about it, right? He goes home, right, gets off and gets, you know, I mean, get into another bus with that other bunch, right? So these are, you know, I mean, these are the little things that we have to get right, I think, as a nation, for us to be successful. Thanks. Over to you, Indika.
Yeah. Thank you. I think Dr. Athula Sumadipala also want to raise a point. Before that, shall we move on to Mr. Hiranpure, because we can take over together, and then maybe Dr. Athula Sumadipala can comment on and take over. Sankar, can you invite Mr. Kure? Sankar?
Yes, sir.
I think I'm on.
Mr. Hiranpure is the chairman of Yetwin Hotels. I think hotel industry is very important in this situation and one of the main incomes and in the country. But at the moment, hotel industry is not sort of going forward due to the situation. So I think now Mr. Hiran would say how we are going to go forward, as well as how we are going to sort of impart your employees and the public gradually into this situation?
Thank you, and aibowan to all. Tourism or hospitality is the most affected industry of all. I mean, we ourselves cannot see tourism taking on until the borders are, the open and people are free to travel again. And as we know, 95% of the world's borders are closed, no free movement of people. At the moment, people are coming in only to be quarantined. That is the students and the Sri Lankans living overseas. At the moment, our hotels in Negambo are being used for quarantine purposes. And for that, we are working with the PHI and the MOH, the Armed Forces, Army especially, with their doctors and nurses. So we have all the protocols that is given to us by them. We just follow those instructions to the letter and do it. So we have a few hotels occupied, but that is only for quarantine purposes. As for total hospitality to take off, it'll take a long time, and we know that, and we will wait patiently with the help of the government also until all the restrictions are lifted. I think a couple of things that even DIG Rohana said, the fact that we are 160th in the world, I think these are things that we need to communicate to the world. At the moment, most of the people are living in fear, right? And there's a fear cycle. I live in an apartment complex in Colombo. And I know some of them haven't got out of their apartment for the last 55 days, right? And that kind of a fear psychosis is bad for the people, psychologically bad. You know, a year ago, we were talking of the terrorism, the ISIS, right, in the hotels. And some of the hoteliers got down doors, got down baggage scanners, all sorts of things into the hotels. And now what has happened? People have forgotten all of that. Now the dogs are in air conditioned rooms, and the people are outside, wearing masks and waiting. So people have short memories as well, right? And we ourselves at Jetwing Hotels, we started what we call peace through tourism. You know, don't forget the fact that a year ago we had a huge crisis in our country. Nobody is talking about that. At the moment, we are only talking of corona, right? But all we and everybody else, I mean, you know, army commander, the police officers, everybody is just going after corona. We have forgotten that a year ago we had a serious issue here, and we all suffered. You know, people were killed due to security lapses, right? So these are all practical issues. So at the moment, if we just work on only corona, people will die of hunger and starvation. A million people depend on tourism in our country, both directly and indirectly. And at the moment, most of them have no jobs or with very few wages, they are surviving. I think we need to talk about these as well. Not only science, we have to talk about practical issues, right? So the hoteliers and the travel agents will wait patiently, because I think that is our civic duty to wait indoors and look after and be, you know, guided by the authorities. And also there's a lot of international studies, because don't forget, tourism contributes 11% of the global GDP. In Sri Lanka, it contributes 5 to 6% of Sri Lanka's GDP, right? And it's the third largest foreign exchange earner. And the president, His Excellency Gotabaya Rajapaksa, is keen to open the borders as soon as possible to bring tourists in. But before that, we'll have to make sure that all the precautions are made. So therefore, we think it'll take 9 months to a year before all these restrictions are lifted, until those are lifted, because hospitality is a human thing. You know, it's a human touch. It's not software. It's not digital. It is, agantuka satkare. And Lankawe pudgalayo wadiyenma usasma pele inne agantuka satkare denne. Lankawe vitarak neme ape kattiye tamai මේ සේවාව කරන්නේ මැද පෙරදිග රටවල් වල මෝල්ඩිව් අයිලන්ඩ් වල මේ ඔක්කොමලා දැන් ලංකාවට එන්න බලාපොරොත්තු වෙන ඉන්නේ. මොකද ඒගොල්ලන්ට රැකියාවල් නැහැ. ඉතින් ඒක හන්ද අපිට ලොකු ප්‍රශ්නයක් වෙනවා මේ සංචාරක ව්‍යාපාරය කඩා වැටුණොත් ඉතින් අපි බලාපොරොත්තුෙන් ඉන්නේ that we are ready to follow all the protocols that is required needed because we don't have to reinvent the wheel. The global organizations are doing all the studies for us, and you know there are exceptional countries like New Zealand, Taiwan, South Korea for us to follow and see what they are doing and learn from them and just implement it. So it's a hospitality will wait till the time is right. At the moment, our hotels are, as I said before, being used for quarantine purposes. Working with the forces and the PHIs and the MOHs in our areas. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kure, Sankar and Manoj. Can we ask Dr. Kumarendra, because Dr. Indika Karunathilake has gone for the Ministry of Health meeting, so I'm taking the last lap. We plan to finish this within the next 15 minutes. So may I ask Dr. Kumarendran to give a very brief sum up of what Mr. Hiran Kure put up. It was excellent, Hiran, because you brought up some important points. So Kumarendran, over to you.
Yeah, okay. என்ன சொல்லி சொன்னால் அதாவது தற்போது இணையமாக எல்லோருமே நாங்கள் கொரோனா கட்டுப்பாடு சம்பந்தமாக மட்டுமே நாங்கள் சிந்தித்து கொண்டிருக்கின்றோம். இதற்கு முன்னும் பல்வேறு நிறுத்தங்கள் ஏற்பட்டது அதுக்கு உட்பட்டா இருக்கலாம். அவற்றின் போது நாங்கள் அவற்றுக்கு முகம் கொடுத்து நாங்கள் செயற்படுவதாக இருந்தோம். முன்னர் குறிப்பிட்டது போல 190 நாடுகள் இருந்தது இலங்கை 160வது நிலையில் இருப்பதால் நாம் ஓரளவு சிறப்பாக செயற்பட்டுக் கொண்டிருக்கின்றோம். குறிப்பிடத்தக்க அளவு சிறப்பாக செயற்பட்டுக் கொண்டிருக்கின்றோம்.
ஹலோ, ஹேவ் யூ ஃபினிஷ்?
சுற்றுலாத்துறை, நாங்கள் சுற்றுலாத்துறையினர் தொழில் இழப்பு என்பவற்றையும் கருத்தில் கொண்டு இனிவர்களது தொழில் வாய்ப்பு மற்றும் அவர்கள் தொழில் வாய்ப்பு இன்மையால் அவர்களுக்கு ஏற்படக்கூடிய பாதிப்புகளையும் கவனத்தில் கொண்டு நாங்கள் ஒரு நடுநிலையான முறையில் முடிவுகளை எடுக்க வேண்டி இருக்கும். தேங்க்யூ.
Bhumathi Stuti, thank you all. Now, I am trying to address the issues brought up by Mr. Ajit Rohana, then Mr. Saleem, and Dr. Hiran Kure, also Dr. Kumarage. ඒක සාරාංශකරණයෙන් පස්සේ අපිට විනාඩිය බැගින් ඉතුරු සම්පත්දායකයන්ට දෙන්නම්. මම හිතන්නේ දිලින් ඉතාමත්ම වැදගත් ප්‍රවේශයකට ආවා. නැවත මතක් කරපු නිසා විතරක් මම මේක කියන්නම්. නැත්තම් මේ මගේ උද්දච්චකමට කියන කාරණ නෙමෙයි. මේ සමාජ දුරස්ථකරණය, එහෙම නැත්තම් සෝෂල් ඩිස්ටන්සිං කියන වචනේ කොහොමටත් දැන් 11 වෙනිදායින් පස්සේ තවත් අදාළ නොවෙනවා. මොකද අපි මේ එම්පවර්මන්ට්, එහෙම නැත්තම් බලගැන්වීමත්, ප්‍රජාව පංගුකාරීන් බවට එන්ගේජින් ද කමියුනිටි එකත් එක්ක සෝෂල් ඩිස්ටන්සිං කියන වචනේ නොගැලපීමක් තියෙන. මේක කාටවත් දෝෂාරෝපණය කියන දෙයක්වත් නෙමෙයි. මොකද ලෝක සෞඛ්‍ය සංවිධානයත් පටන් ගත්තේ එතනින්. ඒගොල්ලෝ මේ වෙනකොට ඒක වෙනස් කරගෙන යනවා. නමුත් සමාජගත වෙලා නැහැ. එතකොට අපි ඇත්තෙම වෙන්නේ මෙතන සමාජ ඒකාබද්ධතාවයේ සෝෂල් ඉන්ටග්‍රේෂන් ඇන්ඩ් සෝෂල් කොහීෂන්. ඊට වැඩිය මම ඒක ගැන කියන්නේ නැහැ. නමුත් ඊළඟට ડોક્ટર දිලින් අගෙන් තව වැදගත් ඉම්පෝර්ටන්ට් කතාවක් කිව්වා. මේ මූලධර්ම මත පදනම් වූ උපාය මාර්ගික ප්‍රවේශය, strategic approach based on fundamental principles which are very important in terms of human behavior. Mr. Saleem touched it, I'll come into details. දැන් අපේ නියෝජ්‍ය පොලිස්පතිතුමා ඉතින් එකක් මම ඉස්සල්ලාම අජිත් රෝහණ මැතිතුමාට පෞද්ගලික විස්තුති කරනවා. එතුමා කරපු විශිෂ්ට කාර්යභාරය සහ පොලිස් නිලධාරීන් ත්‍රිවිධ හමුදාවල් සියලු දෙනා මම මේක අවස්ථාවක් කරගන්නවා ඒක පෞද්ගලිකවම කියන්න. එතුමා මතක් කරා මුල් කාලේදී රෝගීන් හැඟුණා කියලා. මම අර කලින් පැහැදිලි කරා වගේ මේ චක්‍රයේ අපි කාටත් ලෝකේ පුරා it was a global crisis, novel experience, අලුත් අත්දැකීමක්. අපි සියලු දෙනා තෘෂ්ණින් බෝත වෙලා බය වෙලා හිටියා. හිරානොත් කිව්වා fear psychosis කියලා. පළවෙනි අදියර බය. දෙවෙනි අදියර තමයි ඉගෙන ගැනීම, learning curve. තුන්වෙනි අදියර තමයි post traumatic growth. දැන් අපි දන්නවා ඇමරිකාවේ වියට්නාම් යුද්ධයෙන් පස්සේ විශාල වශයෙන් මේ post traumatic stress disorder PTSD, එහෙම නැත්නම් පශ්චාත් ව්‍යසන ක්ලමත අක්‍රමත කියන දිවවුලක් වෙන ලෙඩක් ගැන කතා කරා. නමුත් හුඟ දෙනෙක් කතා නොකරන දේ තමයි resilience, ඔරොත්තු දීමේ හැකියාව ලාංකීය ජාතියට විශේෂයෙන් තියෙන, සහ මේ post traumatic growth, මේ අර්බුදයෙන් පස්සේ දැවත ජනතාව නැගිටීම. එතකොට මේ මුල අවධියේදී බිය ගැන්වීම සාධාරණයි, බය වුණා. අජිත් රෝණ මහත්මයා නිවැරදි කිව්වා වගේ කට්ටිය හැංගුණා. හැංගුණ එකෙන් අර ගල්කිස්සේ රෝගියා පවා එයාගේ ජීවිතෙන් වන්දි ගෙවුවා. මෙතනට බලපාන ප්‍රධාන කරුණු දෙකක් තියෙනවා. එකක් තමයි අපි කියන්නේ ස්ටිග්මා. වෙන්කොට සැලකීමට අර බය බලපානවා. එතකොට ඒගොල්ලෝ බයයි. එකක් තමයි මේක සාමාන්‍ය විවහාරෙත් අපි බිහෙවියර් සයන්ටිස්ට් හැටියට දන්නවා. කෙනෙකුට දියවැඩියාව කිව්වහම එයා යනවා ඩිනයල් ෆේස් එකකට. මට කොහොමද දියවැඩියා හැදෙන්නේ? මගේ කාටවත් තිබිලා නැහැ. පිළිකාවක් කිව්වොත් මොකද ඒක ඔරොත්තු දෙන්න හරි අමාරුයි මනසට. අපි විසින් අපේ හිත හදාගන්න එක එහෙම නෙමෙයි කියලා තනියම මේක ඔරොත්තු දෙන්න හදනවා, හැංගෙනවා. එතෙන්දි ඒ ස්ටිග්මා කියන එක මේ මේ රෝගේ කාටක් හැදෙන්න පුළුවන්, මේකෙන් අපිට පුළුවන් අවම කරගන්න විතරයි, මරණීය විතරක් නෙමෙයි සිද්ධ වෙන්නේ වැඩි දෙනෙක් මේ 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 හරියනවා කියන කතන්දරේ නැතුව ඒක වෙන දෙවනි දේ තමයි මම මේක විශේෂ අජිත් රෝණමැතිතුමාගෙන් ලිමක් කරන මේක මාධ්‍යත් එක්ක එකතු වෙලා කරන්න කියලා නිරෝධානයට යනකොට ඒක යම් කිසි ප්‍රමාණයක් වෙමින් පවතිනවා. දැන් මූණු පෙන්වන්නේ නැහැ. ගෙදරට ගිහිල්ලා පෝස්ටරේ ගහලා නාවක හමුදා නිලධාරියාගේ පවුඩක් පෙන්වනවා. ඒක ඒක සුදුසු මේක විවේචනයක් නෙමෙයි කොහොමදවත්. අපි ඉතිහාසයෙන් පාඩම් ඉගෙන ගන්න ඕන. ඒ ලර්නින් කර්ව් එකේ කෑල්ලක්. ඒක නිසා ඒක අඩු වෙන්න ඕන. දැන් මෙතෙන්දී මේ ජනතාව දැන් ඇවිල්ලා ඉන්නේ ඉගෙනීම සහ බලගැන්විච්ච අවදිය. දැන් මෙතෙන්දී මම පොඩි උදාහරණ තුනක් දෙනවා. අපි දන්නවා අලියා කියන්නේ දවැන්ත හස්තියෙක්, සතෙක්. අලි අපි කන්ට්‍රෝල් කරලා අපේ වැඩවලට පාවිච්චි කරනවා කොටන්දී. සුනකයෝ ඉන්නවා අජිත්‍රවණ මහත්තයලා බෝම්බ අල්ලන්න පුරුදු කරලා අරන් යනවා, කතා කරන්න උගන්වන්න බැරි අය. අපි රිලව් නැටුම් නටනවා දැකලා තියෙනවා. ඒ කියන්නේ බිහේවියර ප්‍රින්සිපල්ස් තියෙනවා, හැසිරීම් රටාව. ඒකෙදි වැදගත්ම දේ තමයි මේ රිවෝඩ් දෙන එක, හොඳ 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 කියන එක, ප්‍රේස් කරන එක. මේ ප්‍රේස් කියන එක මිනිස්සුන්ට, දරුවන්ට. දැන් අපි අපි පොඩි කාලේ ඉගෙනගෙන තියෙනවා දරුවෙක් ඉස්කෝලේ ගිහිල්ලා හොඳ ලකුණු ගත්තාම මගේ හොඳ පුතා හොඳයි, ඒක තව ටිකක් කරන්න කියනවා. දැන් මෙතෙන්දී ඇත්තටම දැන් අපි දන්නේ 45,000යි අඳුරු නීතිය කැඩුවේ. ලක්ෂ ගණන් මිලියන් ගණන් කැඩුවේ නැහැ. අපි අපි කියන්න ඕනේ ඒක ජනතාවගේ බහුතරය හොඳයි. අවාසනාවට වෙලා තියෙන්නේ බොහෝ අවස්ථාවලදී සුළුතරය, මේ බහුතරය පරයා ගිහින් තමන්ගේ අධිපතය බල කරලා වැරදි දෙයට ප්‍රවේශ වෙනවා. ඒක කරකවල අනිත් පැත්තට හරවන්න පුළුවන් වෙන්නේ මේ බහුතරය, නිහඬ බහුතරය බල ගැනීම තුළ. මම දිගට කියන්න යන්නේ මේ මේ අද සහභාගී වෙලා ඉන්න සියලු දෙනාගෙම මම ඉල්ලනවා සමාජ විද්‍යාඥ මිල්ග්‍රෑම් කරපු පරීක්ෂණ පරිේෂණ ගැන කියවන්න කියලා සමාජ ජාලවලට ගිහිල්ලා Google එකට. එයා හරි ලස්සන දෙයක් පෙන්නුවා. ඉරි හතක් ගහනවා, 6 වෙනි ඉර කොටයි, ඉතුරු ඉරි ගණන් එක. පැනල් එකක් දානවා 9 දෙනෙක්, දාලා පරිේෂකයා එයින් 8 දෙනෙක් තමන්ගේ මිනිස්සු ගේන්නේ. පිටින් එන්නේ එක්කෙනයි. අර කට්ටියකින් ඇහුවාම මේ ඉර එක සයිස්ද නැද්ද කියලා මගේ ගෝලියෝ ටික ඔක්කොම කියනවා ඉරි ටික ඔක්කොම එක සයිස් කියලා. පිටින් එන 100ක් කියනවා ඉරි ටික ඔක්කොම එක සයිස් කියලා. මොකද්ද කොන්ෆෝමිටි, අනුගත වීම. ඒ නරක දෙයට එහෙම අනුගත වෙනා වගේ ඒ මූලධර්මෙම අනිත් පැත්තට හරවලා අපිට හොඳ දෙයට අනුගත කරන්න පුළුවන්. මම ඒ මූලධර්ම පිළිබඳ ඊටදී කියන්නේ මට විශේෂයෙන්ම මිස්ටර් හලීම්ගේ කතාව ගැන විශේෂයෙන් කියන්න ඕන. මොකද වෙන not because of anything Mr. Halim, I'm sure you understand Sinhala, you are fluent. ඒ එතුමා අපිට ගෙනහැර දැක්කුවේ මේ ව්‍යාපාරික ප්‍රජාව බලගැන්වලා තියෙන හැටි. ඒගොල්ලෝ මේක ඉගෙනගෙන ඒ වගේම විද්‍යාත්මක පැත්ත දැකලා ඒගොල්ලෝ බල ගැන්විලා ඒගොල්ලෝ අනිත් ව්‍යාපාරික ප්‍රජාවත් එක්ක මිශ්‍ර ජයවදනලා එකතු වෙලා දැන් ඒගොල්ලෝ තමන්ගේ සේවකයන් බල ගන්නවන්න කටයුතු කරන. මම දන්නවා මට මේක කියන්න අවසර නැහැ. ෆැක්ටරිය නංගම් වහන්න ගිය ෆැක්ටරියක් ලෝකේ හොඳම ෆැක්ටරියක් බවට පත් කරපු මේ අධ්‍යක්ෂකවරේ මේ කතාව අහන් ඉන්නෝ. එයා ඒක කරේ බිමේ ඒ ෆැක්ටරිය අයට බලය පවරලා මේක මට කියලා දෙන්න කියලා. මරණ බය නෙමෙයි අපි කතා කරන්න ඕන. අර ඉස්සෙල්ලා කිව්ව වගේ වැඩි දෙනෙක් සනීප වෙලා යන හැටි, වැඩි දෙනෙක් මේකෙන් හොඳ වෙන හැටි, අපේ රට 160 ගණනකට ඉන්නේ හොඳ පැත්තෙන් 160 ගණනට. ඒ වගේ මම ඔබතුමන්ට පෙන්නුවා බුත්තල, මැදවච්චිය, මිහින්තලේ, කන්තලේ මේ වැඩ වෙමින් පවතිනවා. ඒ ගම්වල අය චැරිටි ෂොප්ස් දාලා තියෙනවා තමන්ගේ ගමේ අයට, නැති බැරි අයට වැඩියෙන් සලකන්න. පින් වැට කියලා එකක් දාලා එලෝලු හදපුවා අනිත් අයත් එක බෙදා ගන්න කටයුතු කරන් යනවා. බුත්තල යෝජනා කරලා තියෙනවා නිරෝධාන මධ්‍යස්ථාන. ඒ කියන්නේ තමන් විසින් ස්වයංව පොඩ්ඩක් හරි සැකයක් තියෙනවා නම් ඒ කටයුතු කරන්න. ඉතින් ඒක නිසා මම අවසාන වශයෙන් ඉල්ලීමක් කරන විශේෂයෙන් අජිත් රෝණ මහත්මයාට මේකට මම හිතන්නේ ලොකු කාර්යයක් කරන්න පුළුවන්. මොකද්ද? සරල දේ සරලයි. අපි සටන් පාඨයක් දියත් කරමු අපේ වැඩේ අපේ අතේ කියලා. ඒකේ මම දෙපැත්තක පණ වචන ගොඩක් පාවිච්චි කරනවා. අපේ වැඩේ, මේ අපිට අයිති වැඩේ, තියෙන කොහෙද අපේ අතේ අපේ අතේ ඒක අපි අතට ගන්න ඕන මොකද අතෙන් තමයි මේ වැඩේ යන්නේ ගෙදරින් පටන් ගමු වැඩ බිමට ගෙන යමු සමස්ත ජනතාව සුරකිමු ඕක තමයි අපිට මං ආයෙත් කියන්නම් අපේ වැඩේ අපේ අතේ ගෙදරින් පටන් ගමු පොඩි දරුවගේ ඉඳලා අර අපි පෙන්නවා වගේ බිමේ දරුවෝ තමයි අම්මත හේදුවද තාත්තත හේදුවද අල්ලපු ගෙදර නැන්ද අත හේදුවද කී දෙනෙක් හරියට පාරට ගියාද නැද්ද අනවශ්‍ය විදිහට සෙල්ලම් කරනවද මේ බල ගැන්වීම ගෙදරින් පටන් අරන් වැඩ බිමට ගෙනihin සමාජගත කරමු මරණයට බය නිසා නෙමෙයි මැරෙන්න ටික දෙනයි නමුත් මේ කටයුත්ත අනවශ්‍ය විදිහට ප්‍රවර්ධනය වුණොත් අර හිරාන් කිව්වා වගේ ආර්ථිකයට බලපානවා ජන ජීවිතයට බලපානවා ඒක නිසා අපි මේ කටයුත්තේ සාධනීය දැනුවත් පංගුකාරයන් බවට රටේ ජනතාව සහභාගී කරගමු එතකොට ත්‍රිවිධ හමුදාවේ කාර්යභාරය මේ දැන් මාස ගණන් නිදි මරණ ඒ කාර්යභාරය අඩු වෙයි සෞඛ්‍ය සේවකයන්ගේ බරපැන අඩු වෙයි මේ කටයුත්ත ඉස්සරහට ගෙනියන්න පුළුවන් වෙයි ෆැක්ටරි අරින්න හැකි වෙයි එතකොට සලිම් මහත්මයාට සමහර විට ඒකේ ඉන්න මේ කනිෂ්ඨ සේවකයෙක් ඇවිල්ලා කියයි සර් මෙන්න මේකත් මම අත්දැකීමෙන් ඉගෙනගෙන තියෙනවා මොකද මේකට කරන්නේ අන්න සලිම් මහත්මයා කතට ගන්නවා අරන් ඒගොල්ලන්ට ප්‍රේස් කළා හොඳයි පුතා හරි බය නැතුව කියන්න ඕගොල්ලෝ මේ පංගුකාරයෝ මොකද මේ ෆැක්ටරිය පවත්වාගෙන යෑමතුළු තමයි ඕගොල්ලන්ගේ බඩගෝස්තරය රැකෙන්නේ ඒ උඩ තමයි අපේ ජාතිය ආර්ථිකය රැකෙන්නේ අර හිරාන් කිව්වා වගේ අපේ සංචාරක කර්මාන්තය හිරාන් කිව්වා වගේ මේ ජාතිය 71 ඉඳලා සන්නද්ධ කැරලි දෙකකට මුණ දීලා තියෙනවා 30 වසරක යුද්ධයකට මුණ දුන්නා සුනාමි ඛේදවාචකයට ආවා ඊට පස්සේ පාස්කු ඉරිදා මේ ජාතිය උරොත්තු දෙන ජාතියක් මේ ඒකට නිවැරදි දේශපාලන නායකත්වයක් නිවැරදි ප්‍රවේශයක් සුව සේවකයක් සේවාවක් ලෝකේ තියෙන විශිෂ්ටම මම කියනවා ප්‍රජා සෞඛ්‍ය සේවාව තියෙන රටක් විදිහට මේ කටයුත්ත කරන්න අපිට පුළුවන් ඒ වගේම රජිත රෝණ මහත්මයා කිව්වා වගේ මේ රටේ බහුතරයක් දෙන යුද්ධ කාලේ තමන්ගේ දේවල් කැප කරා පරිත්‍යාග කරා අදත් ඒගොල්ලෝ කරනවා ඒ ජනතාව ගැන විශ්වාසය තියෙම බල ගැන්වීම මම මගේ කතාව මෙතනින් නවත්තලා සියලුම පැනලිස්ට්ට ආදරය ආරාධනය කරනවා එක විනාඩියකින් තමන්ගේ අවසාන කටයුතු කරන්න මම අජිත් රෝහණ මහත්මයාට ඉස්සෙල්ලම ආරාධනය කරනවා තමන්ගේ විනාඩිය පාවිච්චි කරන්න කියලා
ඔව් මම ඉතාම ස්තුතිවන්ත වෙනවා මේ අවස්ථාව ලබා දීම ගැන මට කියන්න තියෙන අපි සඳුදා ඉඳලා දැන් කොළඹත් ඇරලා වැඩ කටයුතු කරගෙන යනවා මේ කරගෙන යනකොට දැන් අපේ ක්ලස්ටර්ස් 31ක් තිබුණා මේ 31කින් 30ක්ම දැන් අකර්මණ්‍යයි තාම එක ක්ලස්ටර් එකයි තියෙන්නේ ඒකත් අකර්මණ්‍ය වෙගෙන යනවා දැන් අපි ඉන්නේ ලෝක සෞඛ්‍ය සංවිධානයේ කියන ආකාරයට මේ කොවිඩ් වසංගතයේ ක්ලස්ටර් 3 ලෙවල් 3 කියන මට්ටමේ කියන්නේ තාම ලෙවල් 4 කොමියුනිටි ට්‍රාන්ස්මිෂන් වලට ප්‍රජාවට මේක ගිහිල්ලා නැහැ දැන් මෙතනින්ම අපිට මේක නැති කරගන්න प्रधान प्रश्न पुदू प्रवास इकट गई मुन वचन मुन परदेश वचनारी सिंगल वचनारी मुन वचन कमे मिचर योनकर दुरती आगने अधिक संबंध ओदगा रोग हेदन रोग लक्षण हेदन කිසිම වෙලාවක ඔබ ඔබ අවමානයට පාත්‍ර වෙන්නේ ඔබට අපකීර්තියක් එන්නේ එංගලන්තේ ඔටුන්න හිමි චාල්ස් කුමාරයාටත් ඇදුනා එංගලන්තේ ව්‍යවස්ථාදායකයේ ප්‍රධානියා බොරිස් ජොන්සන්ටත් ඇදුනා ස්පාඤ්ඤේ රජිනටත් ඇදුනා ඒක නිසා කිසිම ආකාරයක අවමානයක් නැහැ මේ ඔබේ වරදින් වෙන රෝගයක් නෙමේ ඒ රෝගයක් හෝ රෝග ලක්ෂණ නම් ඒක කියන්න ඒ වගේම ව්‍යවසායකයෝ ඒ ආයතන ප්‍රධානීන් මේ නිරෝධායන පිටින් වලට අනුගත වෙලා කටයුතු කරන්න අපිට තවම ක්ලස්ටර් එකක් පොකුරක් නිර්මාණය කරගන්න නැතුව හිටියොත් අපිට පුළුවන් වෙනවා ලෝකෙට ආදර්ශයක් දීලා මේක මෙතන වහ ගන්න. ඒක තමයි මට කියන්නේ.
බොහොම ස්තුතියි අජිත් රෝහණ මහත්තයා. බොහොම මේ ජීවමය ගුණේ YouTube වශයෙන් ඔබ කිව්වා කියන ටික ඉතාම සුන්දර. බොහොම ස්තුතියි. අපි ඊළඟට තමයි ප්‍රොෆෙසර් අමල් කුමාරගේ මහත්මයාට යොමු වෙන්න මම හිතන්නේ අපේ ප්‍රවාහණය කියන්නේ අපේ එදිනදා ජීවිතයත් එක්ක බැඳුණු දෙයක්. ඒ නිසා මම කැමතියි ඔබතුමා සිංහල භාෂාවෙන් අපේ ජනතාවට මේ අවස්ථාවේ දෙන්න තියෙන පණිවිඩය ඒ වගේම ට්‍රාන්ස්පෝර්ට් ඉන්ඩස්ට්‍රි එකේ ඉන්න ප්‍රවාහන ශාස්ත්‍රයේ රැකියා නිලධාරීන් ඉන්න අයට දෙන්න තියෙන පණිවිඩය බොහොම කෙටියෙන් ලබා දෙන විදියට.
ඔව් මම හිතන්නේ මේ ප්‍රවාහනය කියන්නේ සෞඛ්‍ය මැදිහත් වීමට දෙවනිව අනාරක්ෂිතව නැත්නම් ආරක්ෂාව ලබා දිය යුතු මේ ව්‍යාපාරයක් කර්මාන්තයක් මොකද මං ඉස්සෙල්ලා කිව්වා වගේ මෙතනදී තමයි ජනතාව තමන්ගේ නිවෙස් වලින් ඇවිල්ලා එකින් එක්කෙනා මුණ ගැසෙන්නේ එතකොට අර කිව්වා වගේ මේ රෝගයේ ප්‍රවේශ වීමේ ඉතාමත්ම වැඩි අවදානමක් තියෙන තැනක් වෙනවා ඒ නිසා මෙහිදී සමාජ දායකත්වයේ ඉතාමත්ම වැදගත් වෙනවා විශේෂයෙන්ම ප්‍රවාහන ක්ෂේත්‍රයේ සපයුම් කරුවන් හැටියට ඒකේ කළමනාකරණය නියාමනය කරන අය හැටියට මං හිතන්නේ මෙතෙක් ඒ සෞඛ්‍ය අංශයෙන් ගෙනගෙන ගිය ඒ විද්‍යාත්මක පදනම මින් ඉදිරියටත් ගෙන ගිය යුතුයි අපිට කියන්න පුළුවන් අපි මෙහෙම කරා ඉතිහාසයේ මෙහෙම ජයගත්තා කියලා නමුත් අපිට වැරදෙන්න පුළුවන් එක තැනකින් ඒක නිසා ප්‍රවාහනයේදී අපේ සැලසුම් කිරීම ඒ සම්බන්ධයෙන් තාක්ෂණය පාවිච්චි කිරීම ඒ සම්බන්ධයෙන් ආයතනික ප්‍රතිව්‍යුහගත කිරීම ජනතාව දැනුවත් කිරීම ඒ සේවයේ යෙදෙන අය දැනුවත් කිරීම සහ ඒ අයගේ අනුකූලත්වය ගැනීම මේ සියල්ලව ක්‍රමානුකූලව කළ යුතුයි. 11 වෙනිදා කියන්නේ ඉතාමත්ම අත ළඟයි. ඉතින් ඒ කියන්නේ මේ දවස් දෙකේදී මේ දේවල් වලට ඉක්මනටම පාය තියලා අපි ඉදිරිපත් වෙලා සංවිධානය වීම තුළ තමයි මං හිතන්නේ 11 වෙනිදා මේ කරන්න බලාපොරොත්තු වෙන දේ උපරිම ඵල ප්‍රයෝජනයක් ගන්න පුළුවන් වෙන්නේ.
බොහොම ස්තුතියි මහාචාර්යතුමනි. I would like to move on to Mr. Hiran Kure at the moment. I think what you explained was well taken and all those concerns were really true regarding the sector you are the especially about the hospitality management and tourism. So can you briefly give your message to the public and also to your employees? I think they were probably waiting eagerly till this industry starts back and you know revive. So can you tell us what you have to tell and what's the message you have to give at this moment?
I think we have been communicating that to most of our associates. They are now aware that it'll take the longest for recovery. We are, as a company, we are continuing with employment. Most of them have taken a voluntary pay cut, but they are on our payroll and they get paid every month. Some of them, of course, have worked because we have offered hotels for quarantine purposes. So some of the hotels are occupied now. But this is something that we have to wait for the sake of the country. We can't be expecting this to open next month. We know that. And this is a patient game for us. It's a long-term game because tourism is going to contribute significantly to this country's economy. I mean, you know, the money that we get from tourism spreads. Sancharaka vyaparing and videsha mudal hama patem bedila yanawa ekiyanne hotel will the supply karna kattiya elulu waga karna kattiya malwalana kattiya govitan karna kattiya hama taninma tuk tuk drivers la e sancharaka vyaparaya magin yedenawa I think eegulunuth amaryen tama inne den haba eegulanta man hitanne mudal laba ganna puluwam vena vena weda kirimen I think api visheshayen illanne sancharaka vyaparaya dala yanne pa sancharaka vyaparaya gana viswasayen inda මේ අපි අපි we must think positively අපි සුබවාදී විදිහට හිතන්න ඕනේ මින් ඉදිරියටත් මේ ව්‍යාපාරය කැඩෙන්නේ නැතිව අපි ගෙනියන්න ඕනේ මේක මොකද අපිට මේ රට වෙනුවෙන් තියෙන යුතුයකම අපිට විතරක් නෙමෙයි හැම එක්කෙනාටම සංචාරක ව්‍යාපාරයේ යෙදලා ඉන්න කට්ටිය අනිත් එක තමයි කියන්න තියෙන්නේ දැක්කොත් ඒ කියන්නේ චීන ජයවා බටහිර කේක් වේවා අපි හිතන්නේ මිනිස්සුන්ට කොවිඩ් තියෙන මිනිස්සු කියලා. ඒකත් ප්‍රශ්නයක්. මොකද සුදුහමක් තියෙන කෙනෙක් නැත්නම් චීනහම කෙනෙක් දැක්කොත් මිනිස්සුන් හිතන්නේ මේ මිනිස්සයාට කොවිඩ් තියෙනවයි කියලා එළවලු දාන්න හදනවා. ඉතින් ඒක අපිට රට වෙනුවෙන් හොඳ නෑ. මම කියන්නේ මේක DIG තිස්සර මම දැක්කා ටීවී එකේදී එතුමා කියනවා හැම වෙලාවෙම සංචාරකයන් හොඳින් බලා ගන්නයි කියලා. ඉතින් අපි මින් ඉදිරියට ඒ විශ්වාසයෙන් සිටිය යුතුයි. බොහොම ස්තුතියි.
Thank you Hiran බොහොම ස්තුති බොහොම පැහැදිලිව ඔබේ අදහස ඔබ ඉදිරිපත් කළා. මම හිතන්නේ අපි හැමදෙනාම බලාගෙන ඉන්න රට නැවත විවෘත වෙලා සුපුරුදු තත්ත්වයට ක්‍රමයෙන් ඒක පානගයි කියන අරමුණෙන් තව අපි සියලු දෙනාම ඉන්නේ මම හිතන්නේ මේ අවස්ථාව අපිට ලබා දෙන්න පුළුවන් දැන් to Mr. Yusuf Saleem and also to Mr. Ranil Vitarana the executives from MS Holding who would like to take the first opportunity
maybe
please give your message briefly but I think you have to because you have a lot of employees in your yes. industry so I think it's very important to give a message also to the general public because we know this that the garment industry is one of the main income sources to Sri Lanka so it's very important that we have to know your message and your optimistic ideas about the future
thank you I think Hiran also alluded to this it is very important that we get our economy back because the impact the amount of people who are dying outside of COVID will be much greater and the impact will last longer in the larger scheme of things Sri Lanka is a very small a small country small population you know we are point something of the world as a percentage therefore sometimes even in an adverse situation it is very easy for us to create opportunity because we don't need to get 10% of the world's tourists or anything like that we only need to get point something percent of the world's business for us to continue to do well so I think one of the things that we have all been doing is trying to be very creative about how we can use our assets to create new opportunities and one of the things that we are doing aggressively is going after the medical PPE opportunity because we see that as a at least for the next 2 years or at least 1.5 years is going to be a high demand and we need to go after that other things that we are doing as a company is to relook at everything we are doing and saying that now that we can't be in front of each other in order to do this job is there a different process that we need to come out with in order to achieve this job where we don't have to be now in our case we are saying anyone who doesn't need to be in a factory or an office doesn't need to come we can work from home so similarly I think the biggest issue that we see right now in our country is that our government service which is needed by every individual cannot be performed without being in that office and for us as citizens to go to that office so I think maybe it's time that everyone looked at all those processes and looked at say how can we move 50-70% of that work online so that you don't have to have human to human interaction in order to get those things done so that's my bit thank you very much and a great panel
sorry from my side professor on top of what Ranil mentioned I want to give people the confidence that you know this is nothing to be scared about it is a challenge that we have to face and overcome and if we put our minds together somebody mentioned about Sri Lanka being resilient we can do it touch wood with the protocols that we've put in place we spent actually the first week training people and helping them to understand these protocols but now we've started manufacturing we have almost every single one of our manufacturing facilities up and running now some of them are even working tomorrow and you know because they're catching up on overdue orders that we lost capacity producing we hope to get back to 100% capacity next month so from what is within our control I think if we put our heads together we can get economic activity up and running the next part is to understand like Ranil quite clearly mentioned how do we utilize our assets and that's where we are looking at how do we pivot from our current business of you know whether it is intimate apparel or sports or just casual apparel what are the opportunities that are out there because if we do that we are not a huge sort of stomach to fill we are a fairly small stomach and we can make sure that we safeguard our economy so that is my final words thank you
Thank you, Mr. Salim. I think that is very important what you told. We have to take this threat and convert it into an opportunity. And the second thing is that to do that, I think we can use your creativity, the innovation. That's the bottom line of both of your message. I think we have Dr. Dinil with us. We would like to know from Dr. Dinil, what is the message you can give to all our employers as well as to the general public about the communication and how to communicate this message to the public.
Thank you. Thank you, Sankar. And first and foremost, you know, thank you very much for having me here today. I mean, I would start with just one thing, you know. I mean, we got to get used to the new normal, right? The corona is not going to go away overnight. And, you know, I mean, in reality, you know, speaking to the microbiologists, the experts on the subject tell us that, you know, I mean, coronavirus might be around for a long, long time. So it's about getting used to the new normal. And to do that, you know, I mean, we got to understand the basics of this thing and act accordingly, right? And one request I can make from Mr. Ajit Rohan is, you know, I mean, we see too many experts trying to give too many advices, and especially the people on social media is somewhat getting misled, we feel. Right, so that's, I'll start with that request, and then, you know, I mean, I'll come to the most important part. You know, I mean, this was a very good panel discussion, and you know, start with empowerment, right? Then get people engaged, right? And whenever possible, whenever required, we will have to use enforcement. But if we do the empowerment and engagement, right, with, you know, right tools, proper messages, enforcement might not be that much required, right? With that, I would like to finish by basically adopting what Professor Sundaripala suggested, right? Ape vade ape ate gedarin patang gammu wadabimata geniyemu kiyala yojana karamin ehanda wenawa. Back to you, Sankar.
Thank you, Dr. Neil. Thank you very much, and I think now Dr. Kumarendra is there. Dr. Umayana, can you summarize all these messages in Tamil and give a brief count to all the participants?
Yeah, I hope you can hear. Mudhalaaga Pradeep Olivamadivar avargal moondru vidayangalai mukkiyamaga valiyurthirundar. அதான் அடுத்த மனசு வச்சுன்னா நாங்கள் ஒன்று ஒருவருக்குள்ள இடைவெளியை நாங்கள் பொது போயிடுவதை கவனத்தில் எடுத்துக்கொள்ள வேண்டும். ரெண்டாவது எடுத்தமெண்டா நமது கைகளை சுத்தமாக வைத்திருக்கணும். தச்சு வாகனத்தை நாங்கள் வடிவாக பண்ணக்கூடியதாக இருக்க வேண்டும். அடுத்ததாக எங்களுக்கு நோய் ஏதாவது அறிகுறிகள் இருக்குமாக இருந்தால் அவற்றை தாமதியாது நாங்கள் வெளிப்படுத்த வேண்டும். அதற்கான உதவியை நாட வேண்டியாக இருக்கும். அடுத்ததாக எடுத்த மனசு வச்சிருந்தால் பேராசிரியர் அஜித் அமல்குமார் அவர்கள் தெரிவித்திருந்த அதாவது நாங்கள் பொது போக்குவரத்தினை பாவிக்கும் போது பொதுமக்களும் கடைபிடிக்க வேண்டிய முக்கியமான விடயங்கள் இருக்கின்றன. அவற்றையும் நாங்கள் தெளிவுபடுத்த வேண்டும். அதே போல பொதுக்கு போக்குவரத்தை நடத்துபவர்களும் அவற்றை எவ்வளவு சுத்தமாகவும் அதாவது சுகாதார முறைகளின் படி பயன்படுத்த வேண்டும் என்பதையும் இரண்டு பகுதியினருக்கும் புரோத்திருக்கிறது நாங்கள் கூறுகிறேன். அடுத்ததாக கிரான் கூரே அவர்கள் குறிப்பிடும் போது அதாவது இந்த துறையானது பெரும்பளவான பொருளாதார அதாவது அந்நிய செலாவணியை ஈட்டித்தரக்கூடியதாக இருக்கின்றது. பல பேருக்கு வேலைவாய்ப்பினை கொடுக்கக்கூடியதாக இருக்கின்றபடியால் தாம் எதிர்பார்த்து விட கூட காலம் நாங்கள் வீட்டில் இருக்க வேண்டியிருக்கலாம். இருந்தாலும் நாங்கள் இந்த நமது சுற்றுலா துறையினை எதிர்காலத்தில் பேண முடியும், சுற்றுலா துறையிலே நீங்கள் நம்பிக்கை வைத்து இருக்க முடியும் என்பதை தெளிவுபடுத்தி கூறியிருந்த அதே போல திரு ரணில் விதாரன் அவர்கள் அதாவது ஆடை கொத்தலில் அடிப்பமாக இருந்தால் இப்போது நமது அதாவது நாங்கள் முகக்கவசங்களுக்கான மிகப்பெரிய தேவை இருக்கின்றது என்பது அவற்றில் நாங்கள் கூடியளவு கவனத்தில் செலுத்தி அவற்றை தயாரிப்பதற்கு தயாராக இருக்கின்றார்கள். அதே போல ஊழியர்களை அவர்கள் வீட்டிலிருந்து ஏற்றி வருவதிலிருந்து அவர்கள் வீட்டிலிருந்து வந்து அதாவது கைத்தொழில் அலுவலகங்களுக்கு ஃபேக்டரியினுள் நுழையும் போது எவ்வளவு சுவாதனத்துக்கு போயிட வேண்டும், அதனுள் எவ்வாறாக சுவாதனங்களுக்கு போயிட வேண்டும் போன்றவாறு இவர்கள் ஊழியர்களுக்கு பயிற்சி கொடுப்பது இவர்களது வளமையான கடமையாக இருப்பதால் இது ஒரு புது விடயமாக இருக்கவில்லை. பல்வேறு புரோட்டோகால்கள் சொல்வோம், அதாவது நாங்கள் இவ்வாறு விடயத்தில் இவ்வாறு நடந்து கொள்ள வேண்டும் என்பதை அவற்றை அட்டவணைப்படுத்தி அல்லது ஆவணப்படுத்தி அத்துடன் இவர்களுக்கு ஊழியர்களுக்கும் தமது ஊழியர்கள் மட்டுமில்லாது தம்மோடு தொடர்புபட்ட ஏனைய மூன்றாம் நிலை உதாரணப்படுத்தால் போக்குவரத்தினை வழங்குவார்கள், உணவினை வழங்குவார்கள் போன்ற அனைவருக்குமே பயிற்சியினை வழங்குவதில் கவனமாக இருக்கும். அதே போல திரு யூசுப் அவர்கள் குறிப்பிட்டிருந்த அதாவது நாங்கள் எவ்வாறாமையும் இந்த நிலைமைக்கு முகம் கொடுத்து இவற்றை மேம்படுத்தி எமது பயிற்சி உடனாக தொழில்துறையினை தொடர்ந்து கொண்டு வருவதற்கு கூடியாக இருக்கும். அதே போல பேராசிரியர் அத்தனை சம்பதிப்பாளர்கள் குறிப்பிட்டிருந்தார்கள், அதாவது நாங்கள் வந்து என்னென்னு சொல்லி சொன்னால் எல்லோருமே நாங்கள் ஒன்றுபட்டு நாங்கள் எமது கையில் எடுத்துக்கொள்ளும் எமது சுதந்திரம் எமது அதாவது எமது முன்னேற்றம் எமது கையிலே உள்ளது என்று நாங்கள் எமது பொறுப்பினை எடுத்துக்கொண்டு நாங்கள் செயற்பட வேண்டியா இருக்கு. அதே போல திரு திலீல் அவர்கள் குறிப்பிட்டிருந்த அதாவது நாங்கள் எமது மக்களை அதாவது அவர்களை எம்பவர் எம்பவர்னு சொல்லும் போது அவர்களை ஆற்றல் மிக்கவர்களாக இந்த பிரச்சனைக்கு முகம் கொடுக்கக்கூடிய வேலை உள்ளவர்களாக இருக்க வேண்டும், அவர்களது பங்களிப்பினை பெற்றுக்கொள்ளணும் என்கேஜ்மெண்ட் சொல்லுவோம், அவர்களது பங்களிப்பினை பெற்றுக்கொள்ள வேண்டும். எமது பெரும்பாலானவர்கள் நல்ல முறையில் வலுமடைந்தவர்களாகவும் பங்கேற்றவர்களும் இருப்பார்கள், சில பேர் கரிதானவர்கள் இவற்றுக்கு உடன்படாவிட்டால் அவர்களுக்கு சட்ட ரீதியாக நாங்கள் சில நடவடிக்கைகளை எடுக்க வேண்டிய இருக்கலாம். இதே போல எடுத்த போல சொல்லிச்சுனா நாங்கள் நமது தொடர்பாளர்களை தனியே தனியாக கொரோனா சம்பந்தமான தீய விளைவுகளை மட்டும் நாங்கள் தொடர்பாளர்கள் பயன்படுத்தாது நாங்கள் செய்யும் நல்ல நல்ல விடயங்களை வேற எடுத்தால் உங்கள் மூன்று விதமானவர்கள் மட்டுமே கடுமையான நோயப்படுகின்றார்கள், அதே போல உள்ள நல்ல நல்ல விடயங்களை நாங்கள் பாசிட்டிவ் ஆஸ்பெக்ட்ஸ் சொல்லுவோம் அவற்றையும் நாங்கள் கதைக்க வேண்டியாக இருக்கும். இவ்வாறாக கல்லூரியை சேர்ந்தவர்களும் பல்வேறு கோணங்களில் இந்த நிலைமைக்கு நாங்கள் இவ்வாறாக முன்படுத்தி நமது பொருளாதாரத்தினையும் நமது வளத்தினையும் கட்டியெழுப்ப வேண்டும் என்பது கலந்துரையாடல். நன்றி. தேங்க்யூ.
தேங்க்யூ டாக்டர் குமரேந்திரன். நவ் ஆக்சுவலி வி ஹேவ் கம் டு தி லாஸ்ட் ஃபியூ மினிட்ஸ் ஆஃப் தி செஷன். I would like to invite Professor Atul Sumathipala for his final remarks and to sum up the session. Sir, over to you.
Yeah, thank you, Sankha. I'm not going to say everything what I said. Mama kiyapu dewal nawatha kiyanne yanne. Visheshayenma me sampaddayakin siyalu denatama athisein stutivanta wenawa. Meke wedagathma de Sri Lanka Vaidya Sanghamaya bahuvida vruttikayan saha vyaparikayan eka තලයකට ගෙනපු එක ඒ තලයත් එක්ක ජනතාව පංගුකාරයන් බවට පත් කරලා බල ගන්නවන්න ගත්ත මේ ක්‍රියාදාමය අති විශිෂ්ට ක්‍රියාදාමයක් කියලා මොකද අපි උඩ ඉඳන් බිමට if we try to impose things top down it will never be successful it has to be bottom up and top down ඉහළ සිට පහළට පහළ සිට ඉහළට ඒ ක්‍රියාදාමයට නායකත්වය දීම ගැන ශ්‍රී ලංකා වෛද්‍ය සංගමයටත් අනිත් වෘත්තික සංගම් වලටත් ඒ වගේම අද මේ පැනල් එකේ ඉන්න සියලුම දෙනාටත් මගේ ගෞරවය ආදරය ප්‍රණාමය පුද කරනවා. ඒ වගේම මේ සටන් බිමේ ඉදිරියෙන් ඉන්න සියලුම දෙනාව බලගෙන අපි වෘත්තිකයන් ක්‍රියාකාරකීන් සමාජ ක්‍රියාකාරකීන් ව්‍යාපාරිකයන් එකතු වෙලා තියෙනවා. ඒ සාමූහික වැඩේ ඉදිරියට ගෙන යන සියලු දෙනාටම ධෛර්ය ශක්තිය ලැබෙන්න කියලා මං ඉල්ලා සිටිනවා. මං හිතන්නේ මං එහාට I don't need to say anything else. It's very satisfying to see people coming together. I saw this when I coordinated Sri Lankan tsunami in 2005 how people came together and faced this national challenge. ඉතින් මගේ ඉල්ලීම තමයි පක්ෂපාත ආගම් ජාති කුල මල ભેද වෘතික ભેද සියල්ල පසෙක තියා අපි ලාංකීය ජාතිය කියන එකෙන් එතන දෙවුන්දර තුඩුවේ සිට පේදුරු තුඩුව දක්වා මේ කටයුත්තට එක ආකාරයෙන් මැදිහත් වෙලා මේ අර්බුදිනොත් අපිට ගොඩ එන්න සියලු දෙනාටම ධෛර්ය ශක්තිය ලැබෙන්න ඒ කටයුත්තේ ඉදිරිපෙළ ක්‍රියාමාර්ගය කරන් යන්න to take the leadership to the Sri Lankan Medical Association is the professional association of all the professions. I wish you all the success and best. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for that words of wisdom. I think we have come to the end of the session. Today our session was breaking the transmission through community engagement and empowerment. I think the most striking feature of this whole discussion was it was very positive. It was a positive discussion, and it's a positive discussion that will lead to the resilient nation. I think most of you and each and every panelist was talking about the positive aspect and how we can build and how we can go forward despite all this corona disaster. So I think it's very productive discussion and a fruitful one. Thank you very much all. I have to thank Mr. Yusuf Saleem, is the CEO of Process Excellence of MS Holding, and Mr. Ranil Vitaran, Chief Innovation Officer at MS Holding, and Professor Amal Kumarage, Senior Professor of Department of Transport and Logistics Management, University of Moratuwa. Mr. Huran Kure, Chairman of Yetwin Hotels, and Dr. Dinil Abe Gunawardana. He's a specialist in communication skills and one of our own colleagues. And Mr. Ajit Rohan, Deputy Inspector General of Police and a very popular character these days. And at last but not least, our very own Professor Atula Sumathipala is from Keele University of UK. So thank you very much to that expert committee, and thank you all to the moderators, and thank you to our participants. It was a very well attended session. So have a productive weekend and goodbye.